closes the gap. Barry Sanders eventually doesn't have the advantage to get a touchdown.
For any opponent, stopping this fluid and graceful runner is a difficult challenge. With Barry Sanders and the emergence of two of the premier wide receivers in the game, the 5-6 Detroit Lions still feel encouraged heading into their final playoff surge. For veteran Warren Moon and the Minnesota Vikings, they too are still in the playoff hunt. Today, the Vikings expect to make this Thanksgiving Day very special and gain ground in the always tight NFC Central. The Pontiac Silverdome. In Pontiac, Michigan, the home of the Detroit Lions, where they face the Minnesota Vikings. The 56th time the Lions have played on Thanksgiving Day. It snowed last night, but it really doesn't matter in here. Pat Summerall here with John Madden, and we'd like to add our wishes for a happy Thanksgiving to all those I'm sure you've already received. It's a good family day, and we've become family over the last 15 years. And John, the Minnesota Vikings, first of all,
team 34,
started way back when the Lions played the Bears at the University of Detroit. And the stars of that game, John, were real football names. Ace Gutowski and Bronco Nagurski.
Oh, boy. Now you're talking. Now you're talking Thanksgiving. Now you're talking football. Ace Gutowski and Bronco Nagurski?
That's a good start, huh?
Well, I'll tell you, it'd be fun to see some of that around here today.
Fuad Rebez set to kick it off. Ron Rivers and Alan Williams deep for Detroit. The Lions will have first shot at it. Williams. To the 30. This is an emotion-filled Detroit Lion team. Scott Mitchell, the quarterback, he's been hot. In front of him, Lomas Brown, Doug Wydell, Glover, Lutz, and Moss. Sanders, Perryman, Johnny Morton, Herman Moore, and David Sloan, a rookie who they like very much. Number 86, the tight end. Open it with three wide receivers, Sloan in motion. Barry Sanders behind the line. Jack Del Rio, who is starting, led the defensive charge. Up front, Alexander Randall, Tuolo, and Roy Barker. McDaniel and Thomas outside, Del Rio in the middle. Dwayne Washington and Donald Frank, the corners, Thomas. Second and 13. Sanders on his first carry lost three. Big Scott Mitchell. Back to throw. Pass completed midfield. Johnny Morton came up with the catch.
Yeah, we talk about Herman Moore on one side, and we talk about Brent Perryman on the other side, but this Johnny Morton's not a bad player either. He's the third wide receiver. You see, the Vikings are just in his zone. No one touches Morton at all. No one bumps him. No one redirects him. And he just runs a corner pattern and he's wide open.
Coming out of the slot. Sanders. Line of scrimmage. Midfield. No more. Ed McDaniel made the stop, and he'll make a lot before the day's over.
You know, and watching Scott Mitchell on film and just watching him play, it seems like he throws more to the left than he does to the middle or to the right. And I would think at some point people are just going to start loading up their defense or rotating all their coverage to his left.
I don't think there's any question. Of course, he's left-handed. No question about that.
The only problem is Herman Moore is on the right side.
So he's got to turn around and look at Herman Moore. Vikings showing blitz. Flags on the play. They showed it too soon.
Yeah, I think that was David Sloan, though. I think the Detroit Lions moved. Tight end David Sloan just couldn't hold in there as they were trying to audible and change the play. And It looked like the, in fact, I know he moved because I saw him move.
Well, they must have moved then.
Yeah, but I don't know. Maybe he was.
Part of the snap. False start. 86 offense. 5 yards. Repeat second down.
You are correct. Ron Blum is the referee.
Yeah, here he is right here. Watch Sloan there. He just can't wait. I mean, he sees that stuff, and he just, you know, it's on three, and old David Sloan leaves on two.
Detroit Lions, the most penalized team. Second and 14, okay, passing baby. Down.
Got enough room?
To Perriman. Scott Mitchell can get hot.
I'll tell you,
he's been hot.
And he can throw fastballs, too.
Yes, he can.
I mean, you know, you talk about big left-handers like Randy Johnson. He kind of looked like Randy Johnson on that thing. I mean, he just stood up, you know, boom, he threw that fastball in there to Perriman.
Wayne Fonts. Here's the delivery.
Yeah, I mean, he's 6'6", and that's a fastball.
6'6", and 240. Third and about three.
That used to be an offensive tackle.
Yeah. Perriman. Knocked out of bounds by Mincy.
See, now here's what you call a bunch. You see how all these Detroit Lions get bunched up here? All three receivers. Brett Perriman is number 80. He's the guy that's going to catch the ball. He kind of delays. They let the other two run him off. He runs underneath. Now that time, Scott Mitchell knew he was going to throw to his right, so he turned his whole body to that side because he had all three of his receivers bunched up there together.
More than enough for a Lion first down. They're at the Minnesota 18. Timeout. Taken by Detroit. Mitchell wasn't sure. He comes over to Wayne Fonts. Happy Thanksgiving one more time. And it's been so happy so far for these fans. Fans of the Lions, first and 10. Scott Mitchell, the quarterback. Barry Sanders, the lone running back. Mitchell to throw. Delivers in a hurry. Perriman again. Mitchell is 4 for 4. Dwayne Washington on the stop.
Well, he's finding Perriman. Perryman's down here in the on the bottom, and you see the Vikings are just giving a big cushion out there. I mean, it's nothing that Brett Perriman does. He just runs up about 6-7 yards and runs out, and Scott Mitchell throws him the ball. The Vikings really haven't done anything to throw this pass offense of the Lions off. They're not bumping them.
That's got to happen. This is Sanders. Well, we were talking to Tony Dungy last night, who is the defensive coordinator for Minnesota. There's Tony. What do you have to do to beat Detroit? And he said, simply, we have to stop this guy.
Yeah, and if you look at how they've done, and, you know, since 1992, Barry Sanders has only averaged 14 carries against for 49 yards. So Tony Dungy and the Vikings have done a good job against Barry Sanders.
But they got to stop the rest of this. Herman Moore makes the catch. That should be enough for a first down. It'll be first and goal at the 6.
And Herman Moore is out here in the top, and he's such a big target. All he does is run down the field. Scott Mitchell sees him all the way. Hey, and that's Herman Moore's first pass. And you know what these guys, I mean, these receivers, Brett Perriman and Herman Moore, they're very competitive, you know, with the other team, but with each other, and they both want the ball. And that was Herman Moore's first catch.
That's Perriman on the move. This is Sanders. And there's nothing doing. Ed McDaniel again. Wraps up Sanders.
See what they do? They use their tight end, David Sloan. They're trying to get a lead block for him. They don't have another back in the backfield with Barry Sanders. So what they do is they try and use the tight end. And you'll see Sloan coming in motion there. You see 86 here. You see coming around, he becomes the lead blocker right there. He's the tight end. Of course, it didn't work because he didn't get that block, and they were able to catch Barry Sanders from behind.
That's their version of the counter trade. Second and long. Mitchell, incomplete. Flag on the play. Intended for Herman Moore. Donald Frank shaken up in the end zone.
You know, one thing that Scott Mitchell says that Herman Moore likes the ball when he's covered. And he likes it high. And that's exactly what they did there. They threw the ball high, but that ended up in a double coverage. You see what happened? Harlan Barnett, the safety, got right over there. And as Herman Moore went up in the air, Barnett undercut him before the ball got there.
So it's first and goal at the one.
And now the Lions keep Barry Sanders in there on short yardage.
And it doesn't do him any good. He lost a yard, perhaps.
You know, that's one thing that the Lions have never been able to do is run short yardage and goal line offense. For years, they would take Barry Sanders out of the game, which didn't make any sense. And now they just stay in regular formation with one back. At one time, they used this guy. Remember, Chris Spielman used to go in there and block. But now they have no lead blocker. They stay three wide receivers to spread the defense out.
They need two to score. Perriman started inside, was, I guess, supposed to go back outside. That's what Mitchell thought.
Yeah, but he should never do that. I mean, Perriman should never do what he's doing. I mean, now he's arguing with the Vikings. He's getting in a fight. This is stupid. Yeah. I mean, he started the show. He should have just gone back to the huddle.
Enthusiasm is one thing.
Yeah, I mean, he went inside. He was running a post, and they were throwing a corner. That's Orlando Thomas there that is doing the arguing, but I don't know. I mean, that's a form of taunting or baiting or whatever they call it. But what Brett Perriman did there, he didn't have to do that.
No flags.
You see, now he comes out here, and he doesn't like that part of it. He starts to go inside, and Scott Mitchell threw it outside.
But he can be covered 5 yards out. Perriman. Touchdown. That time they were clicking on the same signal.
He's an excitable guy. He ran the same pattern two times in a row. You're going to see him here. He starts out, then he runs a slant. That's what he did before. But on the play before, Scott Mitchell threw a corner. They came back, ran the same pattern, and this time Scott Mitchell threw the slant.
For the extra point, Jason Hansen whistles before. Perriman has four catches, 45 yards, and the touchdown. And Mitchell is 6 out of 7.
Hey, well, we were talking to Wayne Fonch yesterday.
False start, 73 offense, 5 yards, repeat the try.
He'll back Hansen up. Lutz jumped offside.
Wayne Fonch was saying how important it was for them to get off to a good start. And again, that you know that they're going to throw the ball to loosen up the defense for Barry Sanders, but they have to have good pass protection. And on that drive, Scott Mitchell was excellent, but his pass protection was also excellent.
The extra point's still good. Hansen with Royals holding. Perriman. Still got the price tag. You think for what you have, because there are people who don't have. Hansen's kickoff. Ismail downs it in the end zone. It's the Quadre. And here's the Minnesota offense. Warren Moon, as John Madden said earlier, looking very youthful lately. Stussy, McDaniel, Christie, Jarek, and Stringer up front. Scotty Graham, Jake Reed, Chris Carter, Ismail, and Adrian Cooper. His group of receivers. Scotty Graham is not starting. It's Amp Lee
Lee's kind of the pass receiving back of the group.
Carter in motion. Moon to throw it. To the tight end, Andrew Jordan. The Lions defense, they've been kind of porous of late. Scroggins, Porche, Thomas, and Luther Ellis up front. Johnson, Hayworth, and Spielman, the linebackers. Corey Raymond, Willie Clay, Benny Blades, and Ryan McNeil in the secondary. Second and three.
I think both of these defenses have been porous. I think we're going to see a lot of successful offense here today.
Moon. Scotty Graham. Shy of the first down, hit by Ryan McNeil.
Yeah, Scotty Graham is going to kind of be the running back today. So when the Vikings are in a running situation, we're going to see number 31 in there. And then when they go to a passing situation, in fact, they started that way on first down, number 32, Amp Lee is going to be in there. So Amp Lee is kind of the pass receiving running back, and Scotty Graham is the running back running back.
And it's Amp Lee this time.
I'd expect a pass.
You expect correctly. Boom. Misses Lee on the sideline, and the Vikings will have to punt.
Yeah, just before the game, Pat, I met Bill Ford, William Clay Ford Jr., and out here in the lobby here, and he says, you know, the thing we have to do is we have to get off to a good start today. So that's what Wayne said. I said, yeah, well, you always want to do that. And then, of course, they did, because they need something. You know, they have a sellout crowd here today. Their record is 5-6. They've won two in a row, but they need a good start here to get and keep this crowd in the game.
Mike Saxon back to punt off the side of his foot. Brett Perriman back to field it. This one should be returned. Perriman out of bounds at the 40. Scotty Graham knocked him out.
Brett Perriman doesn't watch out. He's going to win a turkey leg early.
He is. 44-yard punt, 12-yard return, a line drive kick by Saxon. 7-0 Lions over the Vikings. Back Silverdome, the Lions with the ball, lead 7-0, first and 10 at their own 40. We give thanks for Barry, Barry, Barry. Barry has been held in check so far.
Yeah, but the Lion offense hasn't, because Scott Mitchell's been throwing the ball all over the joint.
6 out of 7. That one slipped.
Well, they finally took something away in his left side. He was trying to throw to this left side, especially when it's his short side, when he's on the left hash mark. He was trying to throw to the left, and then he had to come back to the right. You see, here's the coverage over there. There was coverage there because this is a guy that was giving him trouble. See, he saw that linebacker in that lane to Brett Perriman, so he had to go back to the right side.
Second and long. Mitchell back again. Almost stumbled coming out of there. Moore makes the catch. Right now for a McDonald's update, let's send you back to Hollywood and James Brown.
All right, Pat, a great Thanksgiving Day moment involving the man who redefined the position of linebacker. Of course, number 56, Lawrence Taylor. Good coverage skills as he picks off his Gary Danielson pass, returns it 97 yards. That pays the Giants to a Thanksgiving Day victory. Right now, let's take you back to Pat Summerall and John Madden.
All right, John, you remember that?
I sure do. That was when, you know, I remember that game saying that there are very few defensive players that can win a game by themselves. And Lawrence Taylor, I always thought, was one of them. But that day, he proved that he was one of them.
That's the longest interception return in the history of this Thanksgiving Day Classic.
In fact, we've been doing this together for 15 years, and 15 enjoyable years, I might add. But in all that time, Lawrence Taylor was the most dominant, or the best defensive player that I ever saw.
It would be hard to disagree.
I think we had to pick like a 15-year all-star. You know, who was the best offensive guy? Who was the best defensive guy? I'd pick Lawrence Taylor on defense and Joe Montana on offense.
That's the way to start a franchise. Mitchell, quarterback sneak, attempting to get the first down. And with that big load he brings, he should be successful.
There's Robert Porche there looking at the Viking offense. They don't have a lot of pictures there because that's a Detroit defense. They're only in there for three plays. So if you got more than three pictures, you really shouldn't be looking that long at them. If anyone is going to be looking at the pictures, it's going to be this Viking defense when they get off the field.
He looked like he was surprised at what he saw, didn't he?
He was looking for more. There can't be no more. There was only three offensive plays. Now he's starting to share it.
Oh, that's what they're doing.
Well, that's what they did. See, those pictures always show you what they did. You're always talking in the past tense. And then you talk the future, what you're going to do to what they did the next time you see what they did.
If they do it again. Sanders fakes a reverse. Barry Sanders picked up about four. Donald Frank on the stop. They've held him in check so far, but
you know, one of the successes that they've had is stopping Barry Sanders early. And then Tony Dungy feels that if you stop them early, that they tend to get away from them. You see here, they're going to pull the offside here, the offside guard and tackle, and it's kind of a counter thing. Fake a reverse and run a counter. They're starting to try a lot of tricks to get the ball to Barry Sanders or find something for him.
It's amazing the number of plays that have developed off that counter trade.
Yeah, that's the first time I've ever seen that one.
Me too. Perryman, the intended receiver. And that fastball took off.
I know, and if he would have hit Perryman there, that would have been a big play, though, because Perryman really had some running room over there. He's a funny guy, Brett Perryman. They say that he comes out, and Scott Mitchell says that he's saying he's open every play. He wants the ball, and he's like 7-11, open 24 hours a day. I mean, he has all the sayings, but he's a couple of guys away in the huddle from Scott Mitchell. And standing right next to Scott Mitchell in the huddle is Herman Moore, who's also asking for the ball every play.
But he can be more subtle about it. Timeout.
Yeah, Herman Moore says he'll be fixing his socks and ask for a play.
This is a Detroit timeout, so they only have one left remaining situation. Minnesota has all of theirs.
Look at Brett Perryman there. Now he has to walk. You see, he's here in the huddle, so he's that far away from Mitchell. And standing right next to Scott Mitchell is Herman Moore. So he can be subtle, and Perryman kind of has to beg from about three guys away.
Moore can get the last word. Here's Mitchell back to throw it again. Pass caught by Perryman.
I think that worked that time because you're going to see they end up with all three wide receivers over on the same side. Here's Brett Perryman. This time Herman Moore, he came from that side. So they got the whole bunch of them, and then they run the pattern off bunch. You got one guy goes out, one guy goes in, and the other guy hooks right in the middle. The guy hooking right in the middle was Brett Perryman.
That's the second time they've done that.
Yeah, the Redskins used to do that a lot. They used to run patterns off what they called bunch.
When they had the posse. Mitchell to throw it. Intercepted in the end zone. Orlando Thomas.
Okay, Mitchell tried to throw that one away. Pat, we know that he has a bad ankle and a bad knee. He didn't want to run. He started to run. He thought better of it and said, okay, if I'm not going to run, what should I do? I should throw it away.
He's very close to being over the line of scrimmage.
See, because I think he knows that he has a bad ankle, and right about here, he remembers that he has a bad ankle. So he tries to throw it away. The worst place, the very worst place to throw a football away is in the middle. You got to throw it out of bounds, throw it outside. And if you're going to throw it in the middle, throw it up in the stands. Throw it up in the stands. But he didn't want to run. He wanted to do something else with it, and that something else was bad.
The ball carrier hit by Spielman before he got back to the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, like we said, if Scotty Graham's going to be in there, it's probably going to be a running play. And when they put Amp Lee in there, it's going to be a pass. And, of course, if you want a guy to play the run, it's Chris Spielman. Now they stop him on first down, so they take Chris Spielman out. Okay, and Scotty Graham is a run guy for the Vikings. Chris Spielman is a run stopper for the Lions.
3 in the game is the lone back. Moon back to throw it. Caught by Cooper at the last second. Moon let it go.
Yeah, and they knocked Warren Moon down on that one, too. I mean, you're going to see the, see he gets the push up the middle, and the pocket starts to collapse on him there, and just as he throws, he gets double-teamed there.
Still completed the pass.
You know, you wonder when you see both ends of it, when you see the one end, the way the pocket is collapsing, two guys on Warren Moon, I mean, he's wondering, how can the other end happen like that?
Carter on the move, second and short, third and short, make it. Moon quarterback sneak. It was interesting, we were talking to Warren Moon last night, asking him if he was having any fun. Vikings on a hot streak, and he was very quick to say no, no fun.
No, the game isn't fun. He said, that, you know, that after the game, when you can sit around and reflect, that's fun. Leading up to it, he said, Saturdays aren't fun, Friday nights aren't fun, Saturday nights aren't fun, Sunday mornings aren't fun, pre-game, the game isn't fun. He said, but after it's all over, that's when the fun starts.
He is such a competitor. Moon fumbles, Lions have it. Henry Thomas, ex-Viking, makes the recovery.
I think that was Antonio London that came and knocked the ball out of there, because he had the ball up. You watch Warren Moon go by. Here's Antonio London here coming from this side. You see, he tries to make the play fake. Right there, London came in, and as he was going by, reached back with his left hand and knocked the ball out.
Thomas with the recovery.
You know, he almost dropped the ball on the play fake. And then London wasn't blocked, come from that side. He got knocked beyond him and knocked the ball out.
Mitchell. Heron, touchdown. If they had to get going early and make something good happen quickly, they just did it. A 20-yard touchdown pass from Mitchell to Perryman.
Hey, and Mitchell got off the hook. He tried to throw the ball away. He threw the interception before. His team came back and got the ball back for him, got the fumble, and then, boom, he goes right in the end zone and throws it.
The Lions owner, William Clay Ford.
And that was his son, Bill Ford, next to him, who told me they had to get off to a good start. Making throws like this and catches like that will get you off to a good start.
Hansen for the extra point. 14-0, Detroit. Well,
it just shows what turnovers do, you know, and that gives them momentum, and then they come in and make this the first play. See, Brett Perryman, he has two touchdowns already. He has a punt return. He started a scuffle. I mean, he's been all over the place, and we're still in the first quarter.
He was jumping around yesterday.
I know. Well, you know, he's one of those guys that's a very emotional guy. He's a tough guy. I mean, he's a real competitor, and, you know, and he'll block, and he says he loves blocking for Barry Sanders because he knows Barry Sanders blocks for him. But the big thing that he does is get open. You know, and he says, you'll watch him, he's gonna run the corner pattern. See him here in the middle. There he is, and that's a perfect throw by Scott Mitchell. What happened is the safety was just too deep, and then Perryman was able to run that corner right in front of him.
Then the cornerback didn't get back, and it's 14-0 Detroit. 1:49 left to play in the first quarter.
Well, Orlando Thomas just kind of sat back there in the end zone, and I've always felt that once you get past the goal line, there's no reason to zone the end zone.
Why retreat anymore? Hansen's kickoff is going to be handled by Ismail. Aubrey to the 25. Minnesota has been able to make nothing happen on offense. Wayne Font.
Yeah, you look at this before Thanksgiving. He's right here, 133, lost 43, 434. Look at this. After Thanksgiving, 18-10, and on Thanksgiving Day itself, 4-3. But, you know, the Lions have always been that kind of team. Yep. They kind of have a slow start and a slump, play well on Thanksgiving, and after Thanksgiving, they get that 10-day thing, and boom, then they really kick it.
Here's Moon.
You know, even Tony Dungy was saying last night, he said, you watch the Detroit Lions, he said, on Thanksgiving Day, you know, playing here at the Silverdome, he said, they even look different. He said, they don't even look like the same team. He said, their body language is different. He said, they're bigger, they're faster, they're taller. He said, they have a complete change on Thanksgiving Day.
Well, as you said in the opening, teams just sort of position themselves for Thanksgiving Day this week and then get ready for the stretch run.
This is the most important part of football from today on to me.
Pass intended for Chris Carter.
And we talk about the receivers that are on one side and the Lions side. We know, you know, Herman Moore, Brett Perriman, we're seeing them do their things, and we haven't seen them yet, but you know, you expect that Jake Reed, who we're just seeing now, and Chris Carter, I'll tell you, that's a pretty good pair to draw two of themselves.
Pretty good tandem. And the guy you got in the slot usually is Ismail. A lot of speed there. Reed is right this time. Carter's in the slot. Blitz. And Lee gets away from one, but can't get away from the rest of them. They timed it perfectly.
Timed it perfectly. Mike Johnson was in the backfield, I think, before Warren Moon handed the ball off.
He was.
Dennis Green is thinking, where in the heck did he come from? But you talk about a blitz. This is a way to blitz. And you make a collision right there. I mean, that collision's as big as that turkey I'm cooking down there. Look at that. Whoom! Now, that is a hit. I mean, when you get the lead blocker and the running back and the quarterback all at one time, you saw something that no one else saw, and you saw it quicker than anyone else saw it.
That turkey is warming, by the way. Here's Moon. And a man wide open. Jake Reed. Touchdown, Minnesota, from Moon.
I'll tell you, that was a perfect pass. And again, Antonio London came from that backside. They didn't get blocked. And he hit Warren Moon just as he threw that ball.
Well, it goes back a long way. You live by the blitz, you die by the blitz.
But watch, here's London here, Pat, and he's going to be hitting Warren Moon right as he throws a ball. Watch him come around this outside right here. Warren Moon's throwing right there. He gets him just after he throws the ball.
Well, that wasn't a blitz. I'm sorry.
Now you say, what happened to Jake Reed? It's a zone on him, and what happened is the safety fell down.
Yep.
You saw Willie Clay was supposed to get over there. Corey Raymond bumped him. Willie Clay, the safety, fell down and didn't get over.
14-7. That'll quiet the sellout down a little bit.
So he can't get over to make that play. That was a zone defense. Willie Clay, number 32, was supposed to be the deep guy there. And as he was switching from looking at the inside receiver to looking out at Jake Reed, he just plopped.
And when you plop, it's not good for your defense.
No, that's what they call the turf devil got him.
19 seconds left to play in the first quarter. 14-7 Detroit. Revez, line drive kickoff. Handled by one of the up linemen. That's not who you want handling.
Stand up ugly.
Dan Owens. Outside the Silverdome, the cruiser waits.
Yeah, then we got the turkey. You know, we already got the thing cooked. There's Willie Yarbrough. He's bringing the last thing. Well, look, we got pies and we got, you know, yams and vegetables.
Look
and
at
then
this
we got
turkey.
Look at the size of this turkey. Now, there is a turkey. You know, we got some legs on there. I mean, here's a leg. Then we got three here. We got three here. It's So I tell you, that turkey needs that many legs or they break their legs falling over.
Flag on the play. That turkey's been in the weight room.
I know it. Well, you know, there was a story I read that what happens is sometimes turkeys are getting so big in here so that they have, you know, so much in the, you know, in that part of the meat that they were breaking their legs. And they only had four legs, and the four legs couldn't hold them. So any turkey that gets this big needs eight legs.
Ball start.
Where did you read that story?
5 yards, repeat first down.
I think it was in USA Today, I think, the other day. And about the turkeys.
The Nation's newspaper.
So big, they're getting so big that their legs can't hold them. So they're breaking their legs. So you're finding big old turkeys with broken legs. So the way to do it, the way I say, is if you want big old turkeys, you have to give them more legs.
Good idea. Pass complete from Mitchell to Morton. Coming out of the slot. That is the end of the first quarter. An exciting first quarter. 14-7, Detroit leads. Scott Mitchell. Second and three, Detroit. Mitchell to Sanders. Cut down in the backfield.
Anytime you get penetration like that, you saw who the penetrator was. It was John Randall, and Randall's going to get penetration, then there's just no place to run. I mean, that's the thing that you can't start. And you're going to watch John Randall right here, one of the best defensive tackles in the game, and he just takes Waddell. He just knocks him back. I mean, that's terrible. Doug Waddell was there ready to block him. He just knocked him right into the backfield. What was that?
So quick. Here comes a Viking. Swarm. Sloan, the tight end, makes the catch. Mitchell read it perfectly. Robert Griffith made the stop.
Yeah, I'm impressed with this David Sloan. I mean, he's a big guy. He's like, you know, 6'6", 260 pounds. And the Lions for years didn't have a tight end. And they finally got one now, and he's a rookie, but he's a big target, can catch very well, and then there's a load to bring down after he catches a ball.
I guess since Charlie Sanders, they really haven't had one.
Oh, and the Barry Sanders, they remember they used a lot of that run and shoot.
Mitchell gets it out to Morton. First down, Detroit.
And we talked to Johnny Morton yesterday, and he was saying that he really has something to be thankful for. This summer, just before he went to training camp, his father was shot 7 times. And he said that, you know, it was touch and go, and they thought that they may lose him, and, you know, and he went through all the emotions of, you know, father being shot and everything, and now his father, Johnny Sr., is doing well, and he said that today he really has something to be thankful for, and it's his father.
Barry Sanders gets the carry, and again, the Vikings make the stop led by Roy Barker. They're doing a good job, an excellent job on Sanders.
Well, again, they're just getting the penetration, and then they have the 8 men up. You see, it's darn near impossible to run into because you not only have the linebackers, but you have that extra safety there. But they didn't need the extra safety because, as you say, Roy Barker was in the backfield before they could even get started. This guy here knows how to stop Barry Sanders.
Second and 13 about. Mitchell gets it outside to Morton. Morton gets near a first down, not quite. Dwayne Washington knocked him out of bounds.
So what Tony Dungy's theory is that you stop Barry Sanders, especially early, and make them forget Barry Sanders and go away from him. And then you know that you're going to give up some passing, some pass receiving, but in the process, you don't give up any big plays.
Sort of what the 49ers did to him early in the year. Had the cornerbacks playing off, and they stopped Sanders, but they lost.
And they lost, and that's in the Vikings are in the process of doing that now, stopping Barry Sanders, but the pass is eating them up.
Juggling as he went out of bounds, but now they say he made the catch. Rodney Holman
There's a guy who's been a tight end in this league for a long time. He's the backup tight end now, but he's been in the league for 14 years. He finally bobbled, but he had control of it before he went out of bounds.
A lot of years in Cincinnati. He's always been a good receiver.
I don't know that he had both feet in bounds, but it was I don't think he had control and then both feet in bounds.
No.
He had both feet in bounds, but he didn't have control of the ball.
The Detroit first down, nevertheless. Here's Mitchell. High and outside.
And that's the first time that he went down. You know, Mitchell has that bad ankle that he hurt a week ago, and at first he was very doubtful that he was going to play in this game. And I don't know how many of these hits that he can take.
Well, he's got a bad knee on the same leg.
Yeah, it's a knee and ankle. And here, that was just a little push at the end. In fact, then he just tripped over another guy going back. But there's Don Majkowski,
the magic.
Came in and played for him last week and thinks he'll be in this game today.
Played very well last week. Mitchell to throw. The catch by Washington.
Yeah, and that's one thing that this Detroit offensive line has been doing a good job of protecting Scott Mitchell, because he really can't take a hit. I mean, if he got hit a couple of times, he's going to be out of there. You see, he's taking that short drop, that little three-step drop, and those inside guys are doing a good job of pass protecting.
When he came up limping a minute ago, that wasn't, as you said, much of a hit. He's 7 out of 7 on third down. This is third and about 5. First down.
Now he's 8 out of 8.
Yep.
Third down conversion. And that's really what football's all about. I mean, you try and get into a good situation on third down, but then, you know, picking up those third down conversions. When you got a big target like Herman Moore out there, that's not a bad guy to go to.
And when you got a big quarterback throwing, a guy 6'6".
Yeah, but a guy 6'6" throwing to a guy 6'4", they both ought to be able to see each other well.
Mitchell goes on a quick count this time. Goes deep in the corner. Moore had it and lost it. Griffith back there with him.
Urban Moore was on the left side this time. He's in the slot, and he's going to run a corner. And like you said, Griffith did a good job at the end. Here he is. Here's Herman Moore. He's coming from the slot. Griffith just got that left hand in there. Watch this again. Here he comes here. You see that left hand just gets in there and pulled Herman Moore's left hand down.
If he didn't do that, it's touchdown. Mitchell.
Spread out for that one. These guys are all doing it here today. We see Brent Perryman do it. We see Herman Moore do it. And now we see Johnny Morton do it. But again, good pass protection. Here comes Morton, because he's going to come all the way across the field. He started on the left field line. See, he sees the zone there. He goes across the zone into the next hole. And then after he goes past that second hole, he says, I better go all the way across the field, which he did.
Got great speed. He just exhibited good hands as well. 21-7. 10 minutes left to play in the second quarter. Detroit ahead by 14. Dome in Pontiac, the home of the Detroit Lions, and today it's a happy home so far.
Well, they all felt they had to get off to a good start, you know, but. By they all, I mean both teams. I mean, the Vikings were talking about how important it was for them to get off to a good start, too.
Short hanging kick to Ismail. Could be. Jason Hansen, the kicker. That's a pretty solid tackle for a kicker.
That was way too solid a tackle for a kicker. Ismail is going to take a lot of grief over that one.
I mean,
Once you get past the group, the kicker should never make the tackle. And then when a kicker makes a tackle like that, that should never happen. I used to always tell my guys, if you ever break, don't ever let the kicker tackle you.
Woo. I'll speak with the kickers union about that. Moon to Carter. A catch.
Watches. Here's Qadri Ismail, and there is the tackle by Jason Hansen. Now, Jason Hansen, watch him. I mean, he got the thing. He gets in a stance. He gets squared up. He puts his head right in there between the eight and the two.
Pretty good
lifts
technique.
His hips. He got the whole thing. Looked like a linebacker.
Yeah.
And then you see how proud of himself is. The first thing he did, and you usually do as he walked off the field, was spit. The first thing he did, he got up, got control of himself, got his bearings, got back on his axis.
Swelled up a little bit.
Swelled up and spit. Moon
gets it outside. Evans gets a Viking first down down at the 29-yard line. Laura McDonald's game break again. Let's send you back to Hollywood and James Brown.
Pat, I know you recall this one 21 years ago this week. An unlikely hero, Clint Longley, comes in to replace an injured Roger Staubach, trailing 16-3, bringing them back. And with 28 seconds left in the ball game, a 50-yard touchdown strike to Drew Pearson. Cowboys win it. Let's take you back to the Silverdome. Pat Summerall and John Madden.
I remember it well, JB. Remember it well. Did the game. Remember the guy who he beat. Boom. Incomplete. Intended or in the direction of Jake Reed.
Yeah, that was one of those Reed type of things where Jake Reed was doing one thing. He was reading where he should stop or hook. Warren Moon is throwing something else. Jake Reed is down here in the bottom. Now watch, when he starts in here, he's trying to hook. I think Warren Moon thought he was going to continue on. In any case, that was pretty good coverage by Corey Raymond. He was right on him.
Inside the Detroit 20. Spielman knocked him out.
You know, the screen pass has always been a calming down play. You know, everyone for years in the NFL, after you would get sacked or something, you'd run a screen pass. And we see what a screen pass is here. Amp Lee is right there. Now, what he's going to do is he's going to set like he's going to block. Then he lets his lineman get down in front of him. See, that's a screen. He has his three linemen there. They form the blocking thing in front of him, and then he just gets in behind, stays as long as he can, and then breaks out of there.
You know, that's a play that looks so simple, but very few teams run it well.
Yeah, and some teams just can't run it at all.
That's Evans. He doesn't get the first down.
I don't think he gets close to the first down. Again, you're going to see penetration here. The Lions are all up in the line of scrimmage, but they get the penetration right there. And when you get that penetration and you can get the hit in the backfield, you don't have a chance to get a first down.
Juan Rivers, one of the best. 18 of 22 on the year. The field goal. No good. I guess I shouldn't have said he's one of the best.
He wasn't on that one.
He missed from 38, and the score remains 21-7. .753 left to play in the first half at the Silverdome in Pontiac.
Four, I don't know.
Two, three, four.
It's two on the sides and two on the bottom.
Well, your turkey's got them all beat.
No, but I mean, that's what they said. I mean, you got some on the side, you got two on the side, and then you got two on the other side, and then you got two somewhere else sometimes.
Sometimes. Here's Mitchell. Down is Mitchell. John Randall.
That was John Randall, and the guy that made the other play is Henry Thomas. Watch him here. And this was the short yardage play. Remember, the Vikings needed a first down here. Watch Henry Thomas. He just gives that slip move right now. The left hand and then the right arm over, and then he comes right down the line of scrimmage. And then that made him, you know, have to go for the field goal, and they missed it. Then his old partner, John Randall, you see him, he just goes right by Doug Whitehall again.
Mitchell. Pass complete. Outside the 30, Brett Perryman made the catch.
And again, the thing this group right here, Pat, has been doing an excellent job, primarily of pass protection. You know, to give Scott Mitchell the time that he has there, because he had the time to get back, to look to one side, and then come back to the other side. And so far in this game, he's had about five or six of those, including that last touchdown to Johnny Morton.
He'll need it now, third and five. Incomplete. Herman Moore was the intended receiver.
That was one of the things the pass rusher was on, and he was just throwing that to a spot and hoping that Herman Moore could dive and get the play for him.
Mark Royals back to punt for Detroit. And David Palmer will be deep for Minnesota. Low snap. Fielded okay. Palmer had a bad hamstring. Gets a chance with this one.
Brooke, the punter did that again.
So much for the bad hamstring. The Lions have had continual problems on special teams. And Palmer rips it 74 yards for a Viking touchdown.
And the punter didn't make the play like the kicker did. Jason Hansen made a play. Mark Royals didn't. But again, the punter shouldn't be the last guy. You see, it's kicked. If it's kicked outside the numbers, you take it back up that side. Good block there. Good block there. Good running there. Missed tackle there. There's the punter. Now, he looked like a punter. Jason Hansen didn't look like a kicker. Mark Royals will look like a punter. What's this? That's this right here. I mean, a punter kind of gets, you know, that foot going one way and they can't do anything about it. Great run back.
That makes it 21-14. Happy Thanksgiving again. 6:23 still left in the first half. Our Aflac trivia question: how many players have won the Turkey Leg Award? Goes back a few years now. How many players have won the Turkey Leg Award? Recipient. Couldn't think of a better guy.
Yep, Reggie White, and that was when he played with the Philadelphia
right.
Eagles.
Now, of course, with Green Bay, and still one of the best. It's going to be a Viking touchdown. That was a fumble, not a muff. Orlando Thomas picked it up. And all of a sudden, the complexion of things change, don't they?
I know, you know, we always talk about offense and defense, and sometimes you forget special teams. This is all about special teams.
And turnovers.
Right. First of all, it was a punt return. Punt return for a touchdown by the Vikings. And then they had a kickoff after that touchdown. They have good kickoff coverage. Boom, they knocked that ball out of there. Orlando Thomas picks it up, gets it in another touchdown. So there, right there was 14 points.
Right.
Again, there was one turnover in there, but 14 points from special teams.
Revez for the extra point. Saxon, the punter, is the holder. And Fuad Revez is good. And it's 21-21. And the sellout crowd at the Silverdome, quiet and in shock, and a few of them are booing.
Watch what happens here, Pat. Here's Charles Mincy right here, number 21. He's being blocked, and what happens is Ron Rivers doesn't even see him. He just runs into his shoulder. Mincy didn't hit him. Mincy didn't knock anything out. Rivers just ran right into Mincy, and when he did, boom, the ball popped out of there. There's Orlando Thomas to pick it up and run it in.
Took the perfect bounce for Orlando Thomas.
You know, and Charles Mincy is a guy who gets credit for. I don't even think he knew what he did.
No, I don't either.
He was, you know, Dan Owens was blocking him. He had his back to it. He was beyond the play already, and whap, he got run into.
Ron Rivers again. Fields that had his kick, and he gets to about the 22, 2 or 3. 1990s recipients, Troy Aikman and Emmett Smith.
Look at Troy Aikman. I mean, that picture there, there's a proud man. There's a happy man. See, he's happy and he's laughing. The only thing, here's what we do, Pat. Now, we don't put that aluminum foil. I hated that. I mean, why we left? You're going to give a man a turkey leg. Give him a big old leg. You don't have to put aluminum foil.
Unwrap it, at least.
So we've come a long way since then.
Well, we've learned.
Yeah. I think that was why Troy Aikman was looking like he was looking. That's why Emmett Smith was laughing. He's laughing at the foil.
Here's Mitchell. With a 47. Dwayne Washington made the stop.
He's going over and telling Rivers it's okay. I mean, he didn't, you know, those are one of those things that happened. It wasn't that, you know, he saw anything coming. The guy was really beyond him. No one knocked the ball out of there. He just fumbled it when he got hit, or when he ran into someone that he didn't expect to run into.
It surprised him as much as anything.
First thing you have to do, though, when a guy fumbles, you have to pat him in the back. I mean, you can't, you know, there's no one that feels worse than he does.
Here's Mitchell. Wheels it out to Moore. Gets to the Viking 44. Donald Frank made the stop.
You know, that Kevin Glover is a good center, and he's doing a good job, you know, of that middle. He and Lutz and Doug Wydell, they're doing a good job, because Mitchell really doesn't get very far back from the line of scrimmage. So you have to get these guys blocked here if this guy's only going to drop to here. You see, now Mitchell's taking just that little three-step drop. He's only about 2 yards there, so you really have to clean out what I would call a very short pocket for him.
Mitchell. Lofts it for Moore. Flag on the play. It's intercepted by Fuller. But there's a penalty marker down.
Well, Herman Moore is saying that it was interference on him. The Vikings are saying that it was interference on Fuller. And the official said that it's interference on Corey Fuller. You know, Herman Moore is one of those big receivers that you always try and get the ball to. Pass, because you're always going to outmatch.
Defense. First down.
Corey Fuller obviously saying, I didn't do anything.
Yeah, this is a tough thing. This is a tough matchup. You see Fuller's out there, and he's just man to man. Now the ball's in the air. I don't know that Fuller did anything.
I don't either.
I mean, it looked like to me that Herman Moore pushes him from behind. In fact, he does. I would say I wouldn't call anything on that play, but if I were going to call something, I would have called it on Herman Moore.
Anytime the Lions give the ball to Sanders, and who again is stopped behind the line.
Sanders doesn't have plus carries. I think that's about the ninth, tenth time he's carried the ball, and he doesn't have, there it is right there, 9 times for minus 10 yards. Every time he carries the ball, there's someone in the backfield.
That's Broderick Thomas who tripped him up that time. Second and 12. 21-21 tie. 3:53 left in the first half.
Yellow. 85.
Mitchell sacked. He was down. Martin Harrison was the first man there. The ex-49er.
Zephyros Moss ran into him. You watch Moss here. He's backing up here. And then when Mitchell comes up, they run into each other. That was the first contact they had, was from his own guy. See, there's no one on Moss, 71. And he goes to turn to find someone, and he runs into his quarterback. Well, we have a lot of guys running into it. You know, I mean, not hits or not sacks or not anything. Just guys inadvertently running into other guys.
Third and 18. Mitchell still looking. Same play that he scored a touchdown on. He came all the way from the other side.
Same play. And again, it all starts with the time. And if you give Mitchell this much time and you let him move around, he's not a big scrambler, but look, he looks to the left, he comes out here, he looks to the middle, and then he finds Johnny Morton. That is way, way too much time. If you give him stuff like that, he's going to kill you, and he is doing that. And watch Johnny Morton extend at the other end. Well, he did. He just got both those hands out there, caught that ball right on the run.
They made the first down. Here's Mitchell. Incomplete.
Yeah, that's what the Vikings have to do. I mean, they, you know, you can sit up here or stand up here and say that they're giving him too much time. The Vikings know that too. So they're saying, hey, we have to get to this guy, and we got to knock this guy down, because I believe if they were to knock him down a couple times, he'd come out of the game.
I started to say a minute ago, more than a minute, about Wayne Fonts. It seems as every year we come here, his job is in jeopardy. And again, that same situation this year. If he doesn't make the playoffs, they'll make a change. So they say. And he says, to his credit, I don't blame him. Mitchell. Incomplete. Intended for more.
Well, now they're knocking him down. I mean, I think after that one to Johnny Morton, I think that they realize that, you know, they just have to do whatever. I mean, whether it's bring a linebacker, you know, get back from the outside, get something. They can't let Mitchell stand back there and stand back there and look and look and look. They have to get on him, and they're doing it now.
That brings up third down. And they've been very effective on third down. Mitchell. Paramount. Incomplete. The ball was on the way before he turned back. As it has to be sometimes.
And Perryman knew that. He dropped that, though. He should have had that. I mean, Mitchell threw that when he had to. I mean, you watch Scott Mitchell coming back here. He sees Perryman coming out of there to break. Like you say, he throws it early, but he threw it perfectly. And Brett Perryman has to catch that ball, and he knows that. I mean, he expects it. You know, once he comes out of that break, Jack Del Rio was right there. He had to throw it when he did, and he threw it right in his hands, and that was just a drop.
So Jason Hansen, Mark Royals holding for 32 yards. He is good with a lot of room to spare. Detroit 24, the Vikings 21. Don't forget coming up the Dockers halftime with JB and Terry and Howie and Jimmy. First half highlights and a preview of the second game today. Kansas City and Dallas. Kansas City, the owner of the best record in pro football this year.
And Dallas, who I feel is the best team in pro football this year, even though I know they did lose to the 49ers.
And to the Redskins.
In fact, they lost to the 49ers three straight times. And, you know, to be the best, they're eventually going to have to get over that hurdle. But I'll tell you, today, we're going to have a lot of halftime highlights. And when you look at the score, 24-21, there's a lot of touchdowns and stuff they can talk about. And coming into this game, I kind of expected this kind of game because we have some wide open passing offenses. And to be honest with you, two teams that aren't very good on defense.
They had two guys who could throw the ball.
Yeah, and that's what, you know, that's not like the black and blue division. Look at this. There's a dynamic duel, Moore and Perryman.
Yeah, the other two are a duo. The other two are good at cooking turkeys.
Now, how about that coffee Bradshaw made yesterday? We came here, Bradshaw was here. He made a triple strong. They had to throw it away. Started rusting the pipes.
Ismail out to the 34. Good return. Good effort.
Yeah, they don't know that in the studio, but when we got here, Terry Bradshaw had made triple strength coffee, and he was the only guy that drank it.
He didn't know if there was a roof on this place or not.
If they'll was, throw it out.
He said, I'm leaving, and he went out through the roof. Detroit 24, Minnesota 21.
Amp lead in the Viking backfield.
Touchdown, and a flag on the play back at the line of scrimmage.
It's in the area of holding, Pat. They're going to call this one back. It's going to be holding against the Vikings.
They're going to bring it all the way back. The flag is down at the 25-yard line.
Little hands to the face. 77 offense. 10 yards. Repeat first down.
Ball against Corey Stringer.
Boy, that is tough when this happens to you. Corey Stringer is right there, the rookie right tackle for the Minnesota Vikings, blocking against Antonio London. And they say that he got his hand up to the face. I guess it was that right hand there. That didn't look like anything to me. I mean, they got to let him do that. Here he is again. Let's just watch it here. I mean, he gets a hand up underneath. I guess that's where it is right there, that hand to the face. Whoa, that is awfully
that
touching.
That is close.
I mean, you got to let these guys use their hands. Here, he puts his hand up there, and he just gets that hand right there by the face and neck. That happens all the time in pass protection.
It has to.
Whoa, that was a tough 70-yard penalty.
Moon has to throw it on the ground, the flag on the play. They might say he intentionally threw it on the ground.
Hey, the Vikings have got some bad breaks on officiating. I think that one on Herman Moore. I think that one there on Corey Stringer. I don't know that those were good calls. This one here I think is okay because I think the ball hit one of his linemen.
I think that's what happened.
We know that they aren't eligible.
Pass hit number 66, an ineligible receiver. The penalty is loss of down, second down.
Hit Jarek.
And John Jarek right here is 66. He's the right guard. Now what happens, they're trying to throw that screen pass, it looks like, but there's no one there to catch it. I don't know that it hit Jarek. No, they said that it hit him. It didn't hit him. I don't know that it hit anything. I mean, Corey Stringer, there's a lot of him there to hit. Yeah, I guess it did hit him on the leg, didn't it?
I don't know. I didn't.
Well, it took a funny bounce somewhere in there. It hit something.
Second down. Moon to throw it. To Chris Carter, who gets it out to 39, to the 39-yard line. This is a heck of a pass, Tracy Scroggin.
Yeah, how did he throw that? I mean, he had three guys on him. Watch Warren Moon when he comes back here. He's just watching, he's looking for Chris Carter. And then things start to collapse. He starts to run up. He has three guys hitting him or ready to hit him as he throws that one. I'll tell you, when you have the ball, it attracts a crowd. And when you're the quarterback, you're going to attack the pass rush. And that's the old high, low, and in the middle. I mean, he was hornswoggled and
whipsawed.
He was whipsawed. I mean, this is a definition right here of a whipsaw. I mean, because he had, usually a whipsaw is like high, low. But he had a low and two highs, and that's a whopper whipsaw.
Yeah.
Denny Green, I think, is right. I mean, he's arguing there with the officials, and there, I don't think that thing they called on Stringer is right. That's a 70-yard penalty. Of course, the referee doesn't know it's going to be a completed pass when he calls it. But I agree with Dennis Green. He hasn't gotten in this first half. He hasn't gotten the best part of officiating.
He's not happy.
I know what he's saying. He said, I'll come in here and we'll take on the Lions, but we don't want to take on the Lions and the crowd and the officiating too.
You really think that's what he said?
No, he's saying it in some different words and with some different adjectives and expletives. Is that expletives?
That's correct. Third down.
Moon.
And lead. Midfield first down.
Yeah, these Vikings are hanging in there, though. They're getting it everywhere. They're getting out of offense. They're making plays on special teams. And you have Warren Moon. You just can't get this guy down. You just can't do it. You can't knock it out of him. He knocked it out of himself on that one.
Got stuck in the turf.
It's a turf devil again.
That's a couple of those we've seen today.
And that's what happens. You just get caught. Watch him here. He's coming back, and there's no one there. I mean, that's his own foot. That right foot just gets caught up in there.
Might have hit one of his own men when he was coming back.
Yeah, well, Amp Lee was close to him. Amp Lee was crossing in front of him, and he could have tripped over Amp Lee.
I think he did.
And that's Amp Lee's responsibility. I mean, you have to get out of there. You have to let the quarterback go back. I don't know that was that his own foot or Amp Lee's foot?
I think it was Amp Lee.
Well, there were 4 feet in one spot, so you know that there's something wrong here.
Sort of like the turkey.
Yeah, we're going to get it right here. See, there's 4 feet, 3 feet in one spot.
The Vikings are down to one timeout now. Detroit has one timeout. We have 1:03 remaining in the first half. The Lions lead the Vikings by 3.
You know, I wonder if they show like halftime highlights coming up. I wonder, 8-legged, we may do that. Don't worry about that. But I wonder if they're going to show all this. I wonder if they're going to show Jake Reed's touchdown and say that was a touchdown too.
Boom, deep for Reed. Jake Reed out of bounds at the 12-yard line. Willie Clay knocked him out, and one of the officials, the victim of a collision.
I'll tell you one thing: that Warren Moon hangs in there, though.
Doesn't he, though?
I mean, he's already thrown a touchdown to Jake Reed that was called back. Jake Reed's going to be a big-time player for this group too. See, he makes a little move on the line of scrimmage, gets past that tight coverage. The tight coverage falls down. And Warren Moon makes a perfect pass. And if you're an official, you better get out of the way. Yeah, we're talking about whipsaw. There's another whipsaw. That's a one-legged whipsaw. That wasn't as bad as Warren Moon's whipsaw.
Moon, handoff to the 10. Ball is down. Amp Lee, the carrier. Inside the 10.
When you see the official pointing to the ground like that, that means that there's no fumble, that the whistle blew before the ball came out or anything happened. And the offense gets to keep it.
One of the officials down on one knee, marking the spot, which is just outside the 10. The Vikings hurry up. Boom to throw it. Chris Carter, incomplete. Got a hand on it.
And his old teammate Henry Thomas was in there hitting him as he threw it. Well, just as he threw that ball, Henry Thomas is going to be right there diving for Warren Moon so that he can't follow through. When they played together, Henry Thomas and John Randall, they were a heck of a pair.
Weren't they? No one quicker.
I think that hurt this Minnesota Viking defense.
Well, that's the price of the new free agency.
Right, and if you're going to have a four-man line, you have to have two good defensive tackles. One guy can't do it.
This is a Minnesota timeout. This is their last one. It's third down. A reminder once more to stay with us to half for the Dockers halftime with J.B. Terry, Howie, and Jimmy. All of the first half highlights, and there are a lot of them.
Oh, yeah, that's what I was saying. They could put Jake Reed's in there and call that a touchdown.
And a Kansas City-Dallas preview.
I wonder, you know, I was watching that pregame show today, and Terry Bradshaw, we saw him here yesterday talking about him making coffee, but he had all those pins pulled out of his wrist or whatever, and he was giving them out. I wonder if he had more pins in his wrist than we have legs on the turkey.
I think the same number, 8.
Did he have 8 in there?
He did, yeah.
Well, he could have made some of the, I mean, ours is legitimate. I don't know if his is legitimate.
I don't think those were legitimate pins.
No, I don't think so either. They were too long and too many.
Keep the turkey warm, we will.
Yeah, keep the turkey warm, Mom. You always got to put Mom in there.
Third 8. Moon. Touchdown. Chris Carter. The Vikings recapture or capture for the first time the lead. 10 yards.
They deserved it. They deserved it because they had to score it twice. Remember the one that Jake Reed had, the long one that was called back. You're going to see Chris Carter. This one looks too easy. He comes in motion across the field. He becomes the outside receiver, makes that move right there. Right after he made the move, he made a little outside move, came right back in, and Warren Moon hit him perfectly.
Revez for the extra point. And it's the Vikings 28, the Lions 24.
Watch this. After he had that whopper whipsaw, that didn't bother him at all because he still has some whip left in that arm. I mean, he whipped that ball right in there to Chris Carter. That was a perfect throw.
And Chris Carter knew it.
Carter made a heck of a move. I mean, that was on Corey Raymond there, and he froze him just enough. And then as he made that inside move, Warren Moon's timing was perfect with him.
This guy set the all-time record for receptions, number of receptions last year. He was drafted by Philadelphia, and they released him. How can you make a mistake like that?
I don't know. Let's watch it again. Here he is right there, and we see Chris Carter's going to go in motion. So that's then you make the defense move. And now up on top, up here, we're going to watch Chris Carter on the top and see Warren Moon on the bottom. See, now right now, Chris Carter makes that move, and Warren Moon saw it. And he goes boom and boom. Talk about being in sync. Those two guys were in sync.
Well, we talked to Chris Carter about that last night, about the sync or the rhythm that he and Warren Moon have now.
Well, they had to have it last year, too. Yeah. Chris Carter catches 122 balls the first year that Warren Moon's with the Minnesota Vikings.
Rivers let this one bounce out of the end zone. And the Lions will take over with 24 seconds and one timeout left.
And Warren Moon says, you know, he turned 39 last year and says when things go bad and he's not playing well, they say, well, he's over the hill, he's finished, he's too old. And like now he throws touchdown passes and he's spry and young and
amazing.
They call him the experienced quarterback.
Yeah.
When you get to be that age at 39, 40 in football, you know, they don't give you a lot of slack.
Here's Mitchell. He gives to Sanders. It's the first time Sanders has had anything you could call running room today. And the Lions apparently will just let the clock run out.
And the fans are going to boo this.
Sure.
And the Lions had a big lead, and they let the Vikings get back into it and get the momentum.
That's the end of the first half, and the Vikings lead 28 to 24. Who's the best running back in pro football? Barry Sanders is always close to the top, as is Emmitt Smith.
I've always thought when you just say runner, you know, Barry Sanders is probably the best runner. But running back, you know, when everything else is included, I think it's Emmitt Smith.
This is going to be Ismail. I imagine the coaching staff said a few choice words to the special teams at the half. Warren Moon's passing.
You see that he was 11 out of 16. Remember, he had one touchdown call back. But look at this. He was 2 for 2 deep, 2 for 2 deep there. So 4 for 4 over 15 yards. So he's had success to the right short side and then deep both sides.
And he'll get another shot right here from his own 18. First and 10, the Vikings up by 4 points. Moon, Reed, to the 23. Total yards for Minnesota, -1. Passing yards, 188. Look at return yardage.
Yeah, that's the thing that the Vikings did so well is those punt and kickoff returns.
Second and five.
You know, we always say that, you know, it's offense, defense, and special teams equally, but we never really talk about special teams equally.
And Lee behind Moon. Moon going to keep it.
He didn't look like an old quarterback.
No. No.
He didn't look anything old there. The way he moved, the play that was called, and the way he went down. You know, you think a guy who's 39 years old and been in the league this long, again, he uses the ball to fake with, but you think he would slide and go feet first where they can't hit you. He puts his head down and goes head first.
He saw who was coming.
You know what's happening there? He's watching the play in the big screen. Padre Ismael.
Third and two. It's Amp Lee behind Moon. So they'll throw it. Jake Reed will get a Viking first down. Run out of bounds by Corey Raymond.
You know what Padre Ismael did on that last play? I've never seen before.
I haven't either.
Here in Detroit, you see him look up a lot because they can, you know, they get the replays up there in the screen. And then you go from there, so all the players look up to see it. But here Ismael is looking up right now. He's looking at the big screen. Instead of looking back to see where Warren Moon is, he's looking up at the screen to see where he is. I have never seen that.
No.
This is Scotty, a 90s football.
Scotty Graham gets the carry. Graham hammers over the left side and picks up 4 yards. Mike Johnson. That's about what they expect of Scotty Graham. 4, 6, 5.
Yeah, what Ismael was doing is kind of the way they do, you know, surgery now. I mean, they stick something in and then they look at a monitor to do it. Remember in the old days they used to cut people open and then, you know, and do the work. Now they do it through a screen, and that's the way Ismael's playing football. From the screen.
I gotta think about that. Moon. Jake Reed had it and it slipped through his hand. Moon was hit just as he let it go.
Hey, you see Moon is getting it from Tracy Scroggins, gets around the corner right on the backside, but then he still gets that ball out there. I mean, this is the amazing thing that they can throw footballs right into guys' hands 40 yards down the field when someone is breathing on him or hanging.
And
on
that
him.
Ball is right there.
That was a perfect throw.
Yeah. Third down. Chris Carter gets a Viking first down, stopped by Willie Clay right at midfield.
You know, both these teams have the other teams in a bind because with their four-man rush, they can't get to the quarterback, and that's what Detroit's going through now. So then they have to blitz. So the bad news with the blitz is if they pick it up, you have man-to-man coverage on Jake Reed and Chris Carter.
And you just about can't do that either.
And they're going through, and then you say, well, you know, we'll zone them, we'll mix up our coverages, but then the four-man pass rush isn't getting there.
And that's the key to this defense. Here's Moon. Plenty of time this time. A flag on the play as Moon goes deep. Intended for Ismael. Flag on the play. And they came out early, too.
And Ismael was arguing downfield that he got hit before the ball got there.
It's going to be, I believe, against Detroit.
Yeah, because this flag was on the side over here. Well, in fact, there's three flags.
Defense, 5 yards in the previous spot. Repeat first down.
And nope. That's a defense. We talked about, you know, that, you know, they're in a bind. So
yeah.
You know, I mean, if you rush or you zone, so Detroit's answer was to put 12 men in there.
And if you get away with it, that's an answer.
Yeah, that's the old 4-4-4.
First and five at the Detroit 45. Moon. Outside. Knocked backwards is David Palmer. Return a punt 74 yards for a touchdown earlier today. Not enough for a first down.
Hey, Ryan McNeil was right there on that play, wasn't he? He caught that ball, was just knocked right backwards. Amplisa, where the heck did that thing come from? Yeah, I think Detroit got caught in one of those things that, you know, they were playing base and nickel at the same time, so they had 12 guys out in the field. Years and years ago in the old AFL, they used to sneak that in against us.
Second three. Here's Maroon. Up the field to Graham, and that'll be enough to move the sticks. Spielman. Chris Spielman playing with a muscle torn in his shoulder, a pectoral muscle that normally would sideline most players. He didn't practice. He didn't have any contact at all yesterday.
Yeah, I guess it's right there in that right shoulder where the muscle was just pulled right away from the bone. He really doesn't have any strength in that right arm.
Scotty Graham inside the 35, about the 33, tripped up by Luther Ellis.
Dennis Green was telling us last night that Scotty Graham's one with his knees high, his pads down, and his elbows out.
Not much to hit. I wonder what he does with the ball.
I don't know. You see, Denny Green is giving him that. That's good. You see, keep those knees high, pads down, and elbows out. Well, the ball must be under one of those.
Buried up in there somewhere, yeah.
Knees high, elbows out, pads down.
Second and six. This is Amp Lee. He gets to the 31, perhaps. Porsche trips him up.
There's a Matt Millen right there, one of our colleagues at Fox. He's doing radio here today. You know, last night, remember, Pat, he was telling us that he was a punt returner.
Yeah,
I said, I don't believe it. He said he was a punt returner in high school. Here he is here. Here's his son, Matthew, watching him. So I said, if you were a punt returner, go out in the pregame warm-up and catch a punt. And the crazy guy says, okay. He did.
In the history of the NFL, no one that big has ever returned punts.
I know it. And looked so ugly doing it.
I thought he looked pretty good.
No, he did look pretty good. We got in an argument. I said, if you can do it, go do it. He said, okay, I'll go do it. So I said, well, then do it in the pregame. And he did. You wonder what he's talking about.
I hate to guess.
I wonder if he's talking about his catch. I mean, he didn't fair catch it. I mean, you know,
no,
Matt Millen.
He's not going to fair catch it.
He's a linebacker, won a lot of Super Bowls, Oakland Raiders, L.A. Raiders, San Francisco 49ers, Washington Redskins. Wherever he'd go, they'd win a Super Bowl. A great guy, but I never thought he was a punter.
Revez from 49 yards is good. And the Vikings move a little bit further ahead, 31-24, with 8:48 left in the third quarter. Didn't have a lot of room left. Hit the left upright, in fact. Bounced good. Enjoy a happy Thanksgiving.
Yeah, and they got turkey legs,
yeah,
too. See, they don't have the whole bird. They know the idea that they just bring a turkey leg.
That doesn't get them admission, though.
Yeah, I know, but, I mean, they're sitting down there in big old couches and stuff. I don't know why they don't eat the leg. Why the leg is still sitting there and it's this late, I have no idea.
Well, they're probably not real eaters. Ron Rivers on the return. Stopped by Martin Harrison, among others. 31-24. The Vikings over the Lions. And again, at the end of the game, we will award our cherished turkey leg. And here's 1991's recipients, Eric Kramer and Jerry Ball.
Eric Kramer now with Chicago, and Jerry Ball now with the Oakland Raiders.
Here's Mitchell. Gets it out to David Sloan, the tight end. First down. John Madden, excuse me, I was just going to say that you were talking earlier about which way he throws.
Well, you know, I always thought he threw more to his left. You can see 18 times to his left, but he threw 13 times to his right, and everything else seems to be pretty balanced. So today, against this Minnesota Viking defense, he's going right and left pretty much even.
Barry Sanders, that's his best run of the day. And again, that sends you to Hollywood and James Brown for a McDonald's game break.
Pat, 2 weeks ago this week, with Dallas leading by one, Miami goes for the field goal. It's blocked by Jimmy Jones. It's a dead ball now, but Leon Ledin, one of his first special teams efforts, touches the ball. It's recovered by Miami. They kick it and win it. Last time Jimmy Johnson lost in his NFL career. Back to Pat and John.
That's a milestone. Sanders has a first down. Out of bounds at midfield.
You know, and everyone knows that it's just a matter, you know, it's just time that, you know, Barry Sanders is going to get his plays. That's Johnny Morton.
Made a couple of key catches, one for a touchdown.
Yeah, those crossing patterns, but you know, it's just a matter of time till Barry Sanders gets his plays, and even Tony Dungy knows that, and everyone will say that, you know, you're not going to stop Barry Sanders. You just want to control him. Here's Johnny Morton right there. You can see he just gets rolled up on just before that, and Barry Sanders gets around the corner.
First down, Lions at midfield. Sanders behind Mitchell. Fake to Sanders. Inside the Viking 30. Again, the defender slipped down, Donald Frank.
And I tell you, Scott Mitchell saw that this was a blitz, and he audibleized. He looked at Herman Moore. He saw it out there, and he just kind of threw that stop fade. You know, where Herman Moore was going up, and he would just stop. But Barry Sanders makes a block. Watch number 20 right there. They fake to him. He picks up the blitz right there so that Scott Mitchell can get rid of the ball.
Sanders. You know, Tony Dungy was saying, we hope that if we stop Sanders early, they'll forget about him. But that's what you can't do.
Yeah, and the thing is that, you know, for a while, the Lions did forget about him. Uh-huh. And they hope that, you know, that they just start passing every time. And that's how they beat him. But part of that is being ahead, too. And I think it has to be ahead by more than one touchdown. I mean, the Vikings are ahead by one touchdown. And I think with this much time, the Lions can still use the balance offense.
This is a Minnesota time.
That's what I always say when someone comes in. How you doing? Come on in, Winnie.
Here's Sanders. This game summary brought to you by Budweiser. One turnover for the Vikings, two for Detroit. The Vikings turned both of them into touchdowns. Barry Sanders, 13 carries, 20 yards, 193 return yards has been the key for the Vikings. Third and three. Mitchell. Moore turned it up, but too late.
I think that was one of those double move things. You're going to see Herman Moore out here. I think he wants to run like an out and up. You see, there's the out and there's the up, and Mitchell just didn't give it enough time to develop. You know, anytime that you have a double move, it's going to take longer. I think Scott Mitchell just let that ball go a little too early. Detroit only has 10 guys in the field.
Jason Hansen.
Here comes 11
from 40 yards. They got the right number now. Plenty of room left. And the Lions get on the scoreboard again. That makes it 31 Minnesota, 27 Detroit. We got all that stuff.
Yeah, one thing you can't worry about is calories and stuff. You know, that doesn't count.
Oh, I mean, no, not on Thanksgiving.
You have a day off on that. Don't do that.
Hansen's kick handled by Ismail. Flag on the play. He doesn't make it back to the 20. The Lions special teams this time do an excellent job. Dan Owens let him down.
I mean, the last time Dan Owens let him down, there was a fumble on the play.
Uh-huh.
I'm sure that's something that the Lions talked about.
Holding on the return team, half the distance to the goal, first down.
Andrew Jordan.
You're gonna see, we're talking right here that's where the hold is. You see a hand up there. I don't That's it. It's right there. It's right there. It's right there.
It's
right
in there. There.
It's right there. There, I got it. It was in that mess there.
And it backs the Vikings up inside their own 10. Scotty Graham is the deep back. Pass is incomplete. Intended for Jake Reed. Broken up by Ryan McNeil.
That was close to be more than broken up by Ryan McNeil. And if it were more than that, that'd be a touchdown. Just a three-step drop, just trying to get the ball out of there quickly. If Ryan McNeil, you know, got an extra step on that, an extra jump on that, he would have caught that and been in the end zone with it.
And Detroit would be ahead again.
Now the fans get into it.
Second and 10. Moon retreats. Jake Reed was his target. No flags. Incomplete.
And now if the fans want to get into it, this is a down. Third down, when your team is on defense, if you want to get into it, when the other team is backed up, this is when you make as much noise as you can. You don't let them hear anything. I think they know that here. They've been doing this since 1934. Not the same people. There they go. Now you're talking.
In a different location it began.
But they can keep all the noise inside because there's a roof on top.
Amp Lee is the deep back. They're showing blitz. Now they back out of it. Moon gets it out to Jake Reed and gets enough for the first down. Jake Reed's a big target.
Yeah, and that's why you like a veteran quarterback like Warren Moon. You know, you're backed up, you're playing away, you got third and long, and you just go and you need 10 yards, you just go throw an 11-yard pass. Seems like today, we were talking about this yesterday, how if anyone gets more than third and five in this league, they seem to hyperventilate. I mean, here he is, third and 10, you just throw an 11-yard pass.
He doesn't know about that.
He's 39 years old.
Yeah, good. Scotty Graham, another first down out to the 35. Willie Clay tripped him up.
Yeah, you see what Scotty Graham did at the end there? He put his shoulders down and his knees up and his elbows out.
That, I think, you call a hunker.
I like that, yeah. Just before you get hit, you hunker. You get down there. Look at that hole. I mean, then right there. That's where he got his shoulders down, his elbows out, and his knees up. See, get the knees up, shoulders down, elbows out.
Yep. Not much to hit.
But what there was, they found real low.
Moon will throw it. By the Lions, Corey Raymond. And a flag on the play. And a scramble.
Well, there's more than a scramble there, Pat. There may be some foreign objects at the bottom of that pile. You never know what's going to come out of there.
Well, Chris Carter came out okay.
Yeah, it looks like all the players are okay.
Yeah.
The officials look like they're okay. No injuries.
One of the officials signaling face mask.
Everyone still has their parts. They still have their electronic equipment intact. Still have their glasses on. I think everything came out of that skirmish okay.
That's Moon's first interception in 194 attempts.
You gotta see, that was just a high throw.
Personal foul, 15-yard face mask on the tackle on number 80.
There's a face mask right there, 15 yards on Chris Carter. They have the 5-yard variety in the 15. I think maybe the second time he went in, or the third or the fourth time, caused the 15-yard variety.
I think you're right.
He's really upset. He starts a spin move on John Jarrett there. Jarrett cuts him just as Scotty Graham hits him. So they gave him the old whipsaw. That during that whole timeout, Henry Thomas was out on the field pointing to the Vikings.
Flag on the play, Mitchell. Fires it for Moore, and he's got a touchdown. there was a penalty marker down. Let's see what they do. I think the Vikings jumped offside. That was from 27 yards out.
Henry Thomas is still upset about that.
He knows.
He's saying this will teach him.
92 defense. Penalties declined.
Roy Barker jumped. The penalty obviously is refused, and the Lions have the lead.
And you're going to see Moore again comes in motion, and then he's running a little form of that out and up. But instead of an out and up, it was more of a flat and up. And he just did it quicker than he did it last time. Remember last time, I thought Scott Mitchell threw it too soon. That time they used the same type of pattern to get the touchdown.
Hanson for the extra point. Lions lead at 34-31.
Yeah, and that when Herman Moore was so wide open, he just had to wait for that ball. This is going to be the type of thing that the last team that has the ball.
Yeah.
You know, earlier we were talking about great sets of wide receivers. Look at this. Carter and Reed on one side have 10 catches for 193 yards. Moore and Perryman for Detroit, 15 catches, 192 yards, three touchdowns for Detroit, the two touchdowns for Minnesota. Those are some numbers by wide receivers. But you got to give a lot of credit to the guys throwing them, too. I mean,
and the guys protecting the guys throwing it.
Right. Henry Thomas is still upset.
Still man.
He's going to put that mouthpiece out. I think Robert Porche is coming in there and say, hey, calm down, calm down. Of course, you know, it's not only that, but they're teammates, too, ex-teammates. You know, Henry Thomas, of course, played with the Minnesota Vikings. And
be interesting to watch him.
Yeah, there's a man that's going to do something.
Yes.
And they had to hold him back on the sidelines because, like I said, at that timeout, he was halfway out in the field yelling at the Vikings sideline.
Hanson to kick off. Ampley and Ismail. Deep for Minnesota. Cadre almost broke one earlier. This one he starts at the six. Flag is down. Another flag is down.
Hey, one thing about Cadre Ismail, he takes that thing up there. He's not tiptoeing up there.
Well, that's the way you have to do it.
And runs it up in there.
This is going to be against Minnesota. It'll set him back.
Yeah, I don't know if Henry Thomas is mad at John Jarek, the guard that cut him, or at Scotty Graham.
On the return team.
I would think it's Jarek.
Number 50, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, first down.
Jeff Brady holding Kowalski.
Yep.
Can't get rid of him.
They just look like two old special teams guys fighting. Old Kowalski. There's a guy waiting for something. I don't know. I don't know that he remembers that today's Thanksgiving, Pat.
No, I don't think he remembers or cares.
No, he has something on his mind. He is one upset defensive tackle. He's not telling the fans to get into anything or anything. You think it's Jarek, huh? Well, Jarek's number 66. Yeah. We're going to find out here in a minute.
Lead down the sidelines. A Minnesota first down up to about the 38. Let's watch him and Henry Thomas.
Well, he's starting there on Jeff Christie, and you'll see Christie's the center. You see it, then he goes to the other side. He doesn't come back to Jarek's side. Jarek's taking the end, and he finally loops around there. So there was nothing happened on that play. That was pretty good pass protection. You know, they took care of that middle, the Vikings did.
Just over 3 minutes left to play in the third quarter. And it's 34-31. Gets it up to Evans. Short game, about three. Tracy Hayworth on the stop.
And the one thing about Warren Moon, he'll move the ball around. I mean, you have Jake Reed and Chris Carter on the outside, but you know, he's also throwing to his tight ends a little, and then the backs out of the backfield he likes, especially Amp Lee, and that's Ampley's specialty as a pass receiving running back.
And Ampley's in the game now. Warren Moon looks over the defense. Three wide receivers and Ampley. And a tight end. They get it to Ampley.
I think that's one of the things the Vikings are thinking of, you know, that every time they put Amp Lee in, they have to watch out that it's not a pass, and every time they put Scotty Graham in, that it's not a run. So once in a while, they pass when Scotty Graham's in, and then once in a while, they'll run the ball to Amp Lee when he's in there. But basically, when Amp Lee comes in, it's going to be a pass. When Scotty Graham's in, it's going to be a run.
Third and three. The Vikings are 7 out of 10 in third down conversions. Moon will throw. Incomplete. No flag. Carter thought there should have been one.
That was good coverage by Corey Raymond, I think, Pat. Number 31, Corey Raymond is running right with him. You see him. Here's Raymond. He's just man to man. He gets the bump there, gets his hands on him, little grab there, and then he runs underneath him. He's watching Chris Carter all the way. Then he looks back with the ball. Oh, he did. He grabbed with that right hand. I didn't see that up there.
Hit the ball with his left and grabbed with the right.
Oh, you see that jersey come back out like that.
Saxon back to punt. Perriman signals fair catch. Makes it, and the Lions will take over at their own 20. In 1992, the turkey was presented to Emmitt Smith of the Dallas Cowboys and his offensive line.
You know, look at this guy here, Nate Newton. He's enjoying it. Now, Nate couldn't wait to get that turkey.
Yeah, he knows how to enjoy it.
Oh, yeah. I think that year, I think I gave him the turkey leg and the whole carcass.
Barry Sanders skips out of a couple of tackles. Finally, Jack Del Rio makes sure.
I think the secret in Sanders and keeping him as the game is keeping the score close. And, you know, now with Detroit up 34-31, now, you know, that's like playing nothing-nothing. I mean, now they can play that balanced game, and Barry Sanders is still a big part of this offense.
1:05 left to play in the third quarter. Moore is the move man. Mitchell. Incomplete. Perriman, the intended receiver. Covered by Dwayne Washington.
And that was a blitz. You're going to see Brett Perriman here. Man to man. Now, on the blitz, this is just going to be a quick fade. He wants to get right by there. Mitchell's going to try and throw the ball right over his shoulder. That looked like it was a pretty good throw. But I'll tell you who made a block on that is Barry Sanders. Broderick Thomas came on the blitz. Barry Sanders had to. You know, when he's in there on a pass, you try and make him block. The Vikings did that, and Barry Sanders came up with a block.
Third and six. Flag, no flag. Yes, there is. Yes, there is a flag. I thought somebody moved early.
Yeah, you know, there's Henry Thomas's old partner on that one, John Randall. The guy you thought moved early was the Lions, but remember, we talked about how these guys right here, here's John Randall here. He and Henry Thomas were partners. Thomas.
Number 87 and 84 were moving at the same time prior to the snap. The penalty is declined. Fourth down.
See what happens is 87 and 84. It's Johnny Morton. When he moves, then that makes double motion. So that was what the penalty was.
So the Lions will have to punt Mark Royals. Another flag on the play. This one was blown before the whistle was, before the play ever got underway.
Prior to the snap, 99 offense, false start. 5 yards, repeat fourth down.
He'll back him up 5 yards with 35 seconds left. David Palmer, by the way, is back deep for the Vikings. Remember, he has a 74-yard touchdown punt return already.
And the Vikings just had the Lions just had two penalties in a row here. That that one on the ends is you can have two guys can shift, but only one guy can be in motion. So you had two guys in motion at the same time, and a shift you have to set aside.
Royals kick is a liner. Palmer stays on his feet briefly, and here he goes. He just got to beat Mark Royals, and indeed he did. That's his second of the day, but there's a flag back at the 40-yard line. 55-yard punt return by David Palmer. And usually, flags come flying.
And usually when you see flags like that at that position, it's usually on the return team. I'll tell you, the Vikings so far in this game have sure gotten a short end on the calls.
They really have.
They've had great special teams today. Or poor special teams coverage.
This one is going to end in a conference.
Well, the one flag was up there early, you know, yeah. where he broke, where you would get a clip or a block in the back, and then the others came late. I don't know what the others would be.
Well, one of the Vikings is signaling touchdown. None of the officials agree so far.
Fouls against the return team. Holding during the return, number 56, 10-yard penalty. Unsportsmanlike conduct between after the clock was dead. Another 15-yard penalty.
Wow.
First down.
That's about as bad a sentence as I've ever heard.
Yeah, because, you know, you're talking about the sentence, but that's tacked on to what was a touchdown play. That has to be driving Dennis Green crazy. That's a second touchdown he's had called back today.
Uh-huh.
And the Vikings have really done that. I mean, they've passed the ball, they've run the ball, they've returned it, but look at that. I mean, it says 9 penalties for 93 yards, but if you add up how big those plays were, that's a lot more than 93 yards.
The two touchdown plays.
Yeah. Yeah, you just add up how many of that long touchdown pass to Jake Reed and that return right there.
Denny Green, I think, has a legitimate right to be upset. Warren Moon will start them from the 36-yard line of Minnesota. Ismail, they take a reverse. Moon's going to run it. And scampers out of bounds, picks up a couple of yards. Let's watch Mark Royals again, the punter.
I tell you, he's the guy that missed the tackle earlier. He's taking an angle here, putting a lot of miles on those legs, and he's not having any success getting anyone down.
At least this time he fell down. Used to be a time you could get out of the picture, but you can't do that anymore.
The turkeys wished that he was the guy chasing them.
Minnesota ball at their own 37-yard line, second down. The Lions leading 34-31. And Detroit showing blitz. Intended for Jake Reed, incomplete. Good coverage by Ryan McNeil.
As you said earlier, Pat, that return play was one of the biggest sentences you've ever seen.
Yep. 30 yards and penalties plus the punt return.
Yeah, I didn't see the penalty, and we looked again and didn't see any penalty or anything wrong on that punt return. But
third and 9, big play for Minnesota. I guess at this stage they're all big plays. Incomplete, and again it's intended for Jake Reed. Massey on the coverage that time.
Yeah, you think about this. I mean, you know, we've already had 65 points scored in this game, and like we say, unless penalties stop them, the one team hasn't been able to stop the other team.
And if they do stop them and they have to punt, they bring it back. Saxon back deep. Short kick. Willie Clay. For the Lions, up to about the 33-yard line where they'll take over. First and 10. 14:39 left to play, and Detroit leads by 3. For Dome, first and 10, Detroit. They're up 34-31. Scott Mitchell, the quarterback. Back to throw it. Perriman makes the first down catch.
Now, who would have thought that Barry Sanders would be used as a decoy? And what they're doing, even though you have to think about him all the time, they're faking to him, you know, with the play fake and then throwing the ball. You know, and that's part of the deal, too, that everyone's worried about Barry Sanders. So if you can't give him the ball and have success, then you just fake it to him and throw it out to your good receiver.
You can still use him if you're smart. The give is to Sanders. He is tripped up again right at the line of scrimmage. And right now, for a McDonald's game break, let's return to James Brown in the Hollywood studio.
Pat, with overtime a possibility in your game, here is the quickest end to an overtime game in NFL history. Dave Williams of the Bears taking the opening kickoff in overtime against Detroit. What does he do? He returns it 95 yards for the touchdown and the Chicago victory. Let's take you back to the Superdome. Pat and John.
Seems like every game they show, I did.
You were there.
Pass is complete to Perriman. Fuller made the stop.
Robert Porche, now he has something to look at. I mean, now, we're into the fourth quarter, so he got a lot of stuff. I mean, he was studying earlier when he had nothing to study.
He had three plays.
But now there's a lot of Viking stuff there. He's the only guy that seems to look at it, though. I mean, the other linemen don't seem to be real interested in it.
Maybe he's the boss.
And on the other side, what they do is they're talking to the offense there, and they're drawing right on those images.
Here's Mitchell back to throw. And the pass is caught by Perriman. Inside the Viking 30, Charles Mincy tripped him up. At the end of this game, John and I will select the Miller Lite player of the game. And we haven't voted yet.
Watch Brett Perriman here. He's going to run an in. He just comes under control there. I'll tell you, Scott Mitchell has really been something today, standing in there. You know, he had that bad ankle a couple of days ago. They didn't even know if he could play, but he has really hung in there today and found the open guys. And, of course, his receivers are doing a good job of getting open, and that middle of his line is giving him a lot of time.
This is a Detroit timeout, so they'll have two left down the stretch. As we'll
cut out for in Oakland Sunday and yep. Detroit Thursday and New York Sunday.
Barry Sanders. That's his longest run of the day by far.
No, but he hangs in there and yep. He doesn't get frustrated. That's what makes Barry Sanders a great player. Yeah, if you need him to fake too, he'll fake too. If you need him to block, he'll block. And then when you give him the ball, you know, it's just a matter of time. He's still a great runner. Look at these moves. I mean, he just gets that thing, and he's going back and forth in front and the whole thing.
Here he is again. This time, the moves don't help. Jack Del Rio wraps him up.
Well, the one thing, you know, that the Vikings talk about on Barry Sanders, that you can't wait. You have to read and attack. You know, like a lot of times, the defense will, what they call, read and react. Well, if you read and react and wait on Barry Sanders, you'll never get him corralled. You have to read and attack. And that's what the Vikings defense has been doing today.
No one is going to react as fast as he acts.
No, he'll always win that battle.
Yep. Second down. Here's Mitchell back to throw. Incomplete. No flags this time. Corey Fuller back there with him.
One thing Scott Mitchell was saying, that Herman Moore likes to get the ball when he's covered. Mm-hmm. He said he likes it as much when he's covered because he said he concentrates more, so Scott Mitchell will throw it to him when he's covered. So in this play here, Herman Moore must have loved it, and Scott Mitchell must have loved it, because he's not only covered all the way, but at the end, he's double-teamed. So Scott Mitchell must have been looking back there and saying, can't get any better than this. Now I got him where I want him.
If this is what it takes, third and 11. Mitchell to throw. Wheels it up the middle, Perriman.
his third touchdown of the day. Brett Perriman's Mitchell read the blitz coming. But there's a flag on the play. An 18-yard touchdown strike from Mitchell to Perriman. It's against Detroit this time.
Ooh. Both of Ford stood up. I don't think they know there's a penalty yet.
Pass interference, 84 offense, 10 yards in a previous spot.
Against Herman Moore.
Yeah, Herman Moore got the penalty against him. Brett Perriman was the guy who caught the touchdown. They were both on the same side. Perriman comes across. See, here's Herman Moore. Here's Brett Perriman. Perriman catches a touchdown. Moore is the guy that they call the penalty on. Again, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, he's doing a release, and then right there he gets his hands up, yep. And I guess they're calling that a pick. You see where he gets that right arm up? He really picked that group off to let Brett Perriman come across.
He grabbed two and held him. Mitchell back to throw. To Morton. Who gets a few yards, but not enough. Robert Griffith on the stop.
You know, here's a play that was called back. Now watch what this height does for Scott Mitchell. Is you don't even see him now. But you see, then once he stands up, he can really see the field. And when he was kind of behind that whole bunch, he just stood up, and then he found Brett Perriman there.
Hansen will try a 40-yard field goal. It was hit right at the line of scrimmage, and it's no good. Somebody tipped it as it started to take off.
I would think if they tipped it like that as it started to take off, that he had to kick it too low.
Yep. You'd be right.
Yeah, because he's going to kick that thing. I think, you know, instead of getting it up, it should go up right now. They did get a little penetration there, though.
Score remains Detroit 34, Minnesota 31. We're up to 15 recipients now. The Chicago defensive line back in 1993.
That was Richard Dent carrying the whole turkey in there.
He knew what to do with it.
Yeah.
Moon dumps it out to Amp Lee. Lee stays on his feet and picks up 8 or 9. Corey Raymond knocked him out of bounds.
You know, with all this passing in this game, that means that everyone has to run a lot more. The defensive linemen have to run more because they have to pass rush. The linebackers have to run more in coverage. The defensive backs, the wide receivers. And it looks like the teams are getting a little tired now. And they're starting to get a little sloppy. They're missing more tackles now than they were earlier in the game.
And that's a good sign of fatigue. They need a yard. Scotty Graham's the running back. Graham got the yard. There's a flag on the play, however.
Oh, no, that's going to be against the Vikings. They're holding.
They had the first down.
Boy, that'll kill you. I mean, you got a short yardage play. You only need a yard, and you hold on a running play up the middle. Whew. They never used to call
holding
that.
77 offense, 10 yards, repeat second down.
Stringer.
Yep, Stringer's right here. Corey Stringer, the big rookie tackle. The referee called that from behind. I don't know about that. I mean, you got to let him block like that. I think that's a bad call. I really think that the Vikings have had a lot of bad calls against them today. I mean, you know, you got to let them use their hands there. And if they get outside the framework, but the defensive guy puts himself outside the framework.
But that's within the rules. Here's Moon. Flags come flying from everywhere. Intercepted by Ryan McNeil, but this has got to be against the Lions. And that'll be an automatic first down.
These officials are sure a part of this game, aren't they? We had them at our dinner last night.
47 defense.
They're working off some dinner today.
47 is Ryan McNeil there. He was a guy that got the interception. And you see him bump there. Now, again, you can bump in the first 5 yards, but you can't bump after the ball's in the air. I think that could have been within 5 yards, but the ball was in the air.
David Palmer was the receiver. It's first down, Minnesota, at their own 36. 9-11 left to play. Moon back to throw it. And Lee gets out of bounds outside the 40, about the 41-yard line. Taken out by Benny Blades. First time we've mentioned his name today.
Yeah, well, Benny Blades has really been banged up. I mean, he has a bad back, and you just watch him in practice and just walking around. He has a tough time walking around. Like, he's been, over the years, had been a great safety, lost some of his speed. And Wayne Fonts was saying yesterday that he thinks that he'll end up playing as a weak side linebacker.
Second down, about 6. Moon over the head of Carter. Incomplete.
Yeah, you get the feeling before this is over that Warren Moon is going to get a big play to Chris Carter. I mean, that's what he's looking for. He said early in the season that was one of the problems they were having, that he was trying to force the ball too much to Chris Carter. And then he said then he kind of started balancing it and getting guys around, and he said he got a lot better. And then they got in sync. But you can just feel that their go-to guy when they need a big play is Chris Carter. And from now on, the rest of this game, they're going to be looking for him.
Third down. They're 7 out of 12 on their third down conversions. They got to hurry. Just got the ball snapped in time, and Moon goes down.
Oh, and Chris Carter knows it, too. And he could have hit him that time perfectly. There was no one on him. And if Warren Moon would have just came up and hit him, he would have had him. That's what Chris Carter's saying.
As Henry Thomas, who led the charge.
And you see Warren Moon is looking to the left. Then he gets the pressure right there. Had he just looked to the right, he would have saw that Chris Carter was wide open right away.
Saxon back to punt.
Here you're going to see Chris Carter right here. You see right now he's open.
Saxon's punt again off the side of his foot. Takes a Minnesota bounce and still rolling. Favor of the Vikings inside the 10, about the 7. That looked like nothing, but Saxon got the roll and it turned into a fine punt. You never know. 34-31 Detroit. Lion ball. Mitchell back to throw it. Going deep for Morton, incomplete. He had it and lost it, covered by Griffith.
This is a big area here for the, you know, for both teams, that the Lions have to get out of there. Mitchell tried to get it in one play to Johnny Morton, and then the Vikings are looking to stop him here and get good field position. Now, the thing that the Lions have to think of is they can't turn the ball over, because a turnover down here is an automatic score.
Second and 10. That high throw that he could reach up and snatch.
I know it. And Scott Mitchell, you know, he's not a scrambler.
No.
But he moves around just enough to find a hole. You see him here? He just comes to the left here, moves up. You know, he starts to his right. Then he moves up a little. That buys him enough time to find his big target down there, Herman Moore.
First down, Detroit. The handoff is to Sanders. And look out. And the Vikings recovered in the end zone.
Right at the end, all they tried to do was strip it, Pat, so that's going to be the Vikings ball on the 20-yard line.
Recovered by Orlando Thomas.
Well, come in from behind. You see, they don't even try right there to tackle. They're trying for the strip all the way. See, not to tackle, tried to strip the first time, tried to strip the second time, and finally got it on the third time. And then the ball's kicked forward, and now that it's recovered in the end zone, that'll be a touchback. It'll be Minnesota's ball in the 20-yard line. Well, I'll tell you, Corey Fuller stayed with that. Yeah. I mean, he wasn't going for the tackle. He was going for the strip all the way, and he didn't get it the first time.
Didn't get
and
it
he
the second time.
He brought down a second chop, and then finally chopped it out of there on the third time. Watch him. He goes here, tries once, tries twice, then on the third time, he just jerks it right out of there.
First and 10, Minnesota at their own 20. Moon. Scotty Graham doesn't make it back to the line of scrimmage as Chris Spielman is in to stop him.
Chris Spielman could still play that run, can he?
He really can. The odds good. 6 minutes and 45 seconds now left to play. 34-31 Detroit.
And he did his job. They're just playing Chris Spielman today basically against the run. And then they go to a form and nickel defense when they get the Vikings in long yardage. So that's a problem. If Spielman in the middle of it, you do your job, then they take you out after first down.
Second and long. Moon. Up the middle to Antley, incomplete. That one could have been caught.
Yeah, you can just tell that these guys are really tired. I mean, you look at the defensive backs and the wide receivers. This has been like a track meet for them. All this passing and everything, and you know, and having to cover and just run all day. You know, Dennis Green is thinking, just give us a couple plays here. Let's catch one break here.
Moon is just 2 out of 6 in the fourth quarter. So the Lions have clamped a little lid on him. And the lid closes a little faster as the blitz gets him back at the 10. Antonio London.
They've had trouble all day with Antonio London. If there's anyone that's been getting pressure, it's been this guy, number 55. And you watch him. He's just coming from the backside. They try and keep a tight end on him. The tight end can't do it. He hits him with the right, gets that arm over, and he's right on Warren Moon.
And Saxon will punt out of his own end zone. Willie Clay back deep for Detroit. Good snap. Better kick by Saxon. Chases Clay back to the 37. Here's cut down at midfield. Scotty Graham. Again, the Aflac trivia question. How many players have won that cherished turkey leg award in this Thanksgiving Day Classic? In 1994, remember the day that Jason Garrett had? He got part of the turkey. Charles Haley, Smith, and the Dallas offensive line. It brings our total up to 23 players.
Yeah, Jason Garrett's wife just said, throw the ball deep to Harper. The second half, that's what he did.
And that turned out to be good advice. Here's Mitchell. Pump fake going deep. No flag. Dwayne Washington.
I'll tell you one thing I like about this game, Pat, is these teams both said before that they're going to come out passing. And they not only came out passing, but they've been passing all day.
Yeah. And we talked about the black and blue division having changed complexion.
Well, it really has. Yeah. You know, it used to be running game, good solid defense, played outdoors. Now it's played indoors, passing game, and no defense.
Sanders. He is gone.
Watch him. He won't celebrate either. Well, maybe a little celebration.
50 yards by Barry Sanders.
And Tony Dungy was saying, he said, you get 0-0, -2, -2, 1 yard with Barry Sanders, and then whack, 40 yards for a touchdown.
Well, he almost broke one earlier and then fumbled at the end.
Well, you know, a guy with the pride like him and the greatness of Barry Sanders, after that fumble, there was no way he was going to fumble again. There was no way he was going to let him catch him again so that they would be in position that they could grab that ball out of there.
Whew. It's hard to take the right angle when you're chasing Barry Sanders. Not many people have. Look at his eyes.
Look at this. He has that shield on there now. But these guys not only feel everything, they see everything. They know where everyone's coming from and where everyone is. And then when they figure it out, they just outrun them.
For years, it was the Lions and the Packers. And Vince Lombardi said, why should we have to travel and play every Thanksgiving Day? So they started alternating teams, and it's turned out, many think, to be an advantage.
I think it's a real advantage for the Detroit Lions. I think the Dallas Cowboys turned into an advantage to them.
Hanson's kick is high to Ismail. To the 35.
There's a guy, Pat. Remember Mike Gutley?
Sure.
Great offensive lineman for the Detroit Lions that was injured and paralyzed in a game. Had a chance to talk to him yesterday. Boy, does he have spirit.
He really does.
Well, you know, he's skydiving. In fact, we got a picture of him. Here he is right here. Now, he's getting anyone who could do this. I have no idea. I was asking him how they could do it. He's pointing to his altimeter. They just throw him out of the thing. And he goes skydiving. I was thinking, how can you do this? And he said it's the closest thing that he can experience to football.
And Chase Moon, Lee gets the screen pass. And Lee gets to the 41, 42 maybe. Van Horst made the stop. Excuse me.
Well, I was just saying the land. He says that, you know, since he's been out of football, he's been finding something that is like football. And he said this is one of the things that he's looking at.
You know, I always thought I wanted to do that, but not if they're going to throw me out of the airplane.
Well, maybe you slide. I asked him about that, and he said, that's a tough part. He said, you get up there, and you got to go. But, I mean, you love to see that. You love to see the spirit that Mike Gutley has. I mean, he's not only doing that. He's scuba diving, lifting weights.
Durant Lee from Moon at midfield. First down, Vikings. Mike Johnson made the stop. 4:16 left to play. The Vikings have two timeouts left.
You know, he comes back here all the time on Thanksgiving, and the players all love to see him. He loves to see the players, you know, kind of get back and be one of the guys again. And I mean, he's always laughing, you know, smiling his face. The guys come by, he jokes with everyone, and I don't know, he's a man.
Indeed he is. Here's Moon. He's a man. To Ant Lee. Dragged down by Sean Van Horst. This game is presented by authority of the National Football League. It's intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of the Detroit Lions and the National Football League is prohibited.
And Herman Moore there. I mean, he was playing like a lineman. I mean, he got some stuff all over his pants. He got some blood up there in the upper leg. His shirt tail is hanging out. He got his cap on backwards. I mean, he looks like he's a guard.
Until he stands up.
Runs out for a pattern.
Evans, the receiver. Spielman made the stop. It's a Minnesota first down. Barry Sanders, who just made that 50-yard touchdown run.
You know, he said the reason he never celebrates or shows any emotion is because there's more work to be done. He said if it was ever the last play of a game in a Super Bowl, maybe he would. But until then, he doesn't see that there's any reason to celebrate until all your work's done.
Lions didn't have enough men in. The pass is deflected by the man who just got there, Mike Wells. Moon is down by Antonio London.
Yeah, London is the guy that's been the pass rush guy for the Lions. Or if anyone's been close all day to Moon, it seems like it's London. You know, he's been there all the time. Wells is a guy 95 that knocks the ball down. London is right there to hit Warren Moon, and it was knocked down at the line of scrimmage by Wells.
Second and 10. There at the Detroit 35 and a half yard line. 2:29 left. Moon to throw it. Again to Amp Lee, and Lee gets down to inside the 20, about the 17. Run out by Van Horst.
You know, they just keep throwing in this game. One team scores, all of Barry Sanders are running. And then the Vikings, Warren Moon, they just keep coming. They got their pass production down. I'll tell you, it's tough to rush all day the way both of these defensive lines have had.
That is the most tiring thing you can imagine, at rushing the passer.
And then I think those defensive backs having to run all over the field chasing those wide receivers.
220 left.
Thing.
Oh, sure it is. Moon to throw. Evades a couple. Moon takes off and runs out of bounds. Stops the clock at about the 13. Today's game is being produced by Bob Stenner and directed by Sandy Grossman, who wish you all a happy Thanksgiving as well. The studio was produced by Scott Ackerson and directed by Bob Levy. Executive producers of Fox Sports are Ed Gorin and David Hill. There was a flag on that last play.
And the flag is against Detroit. And it was holding, so it's going to be automatic first down for the Vikings.
And they'll move it down inside the 10 to the 8. So it's first and goal at the 8.
And the Vikings, again, 2 minutes, 13 seconds. They have 2 timeouts left. But they have to be thinking in terms of 2 scores. To tie, they got to get a touchdown, an extra point, and a field goal. To win, they could go a touchdown, go for 2, and get a field goal and win.
Moon. And open, Carter, touchdown. Looks so easy.
Yep, it's been, I think that the offenses have just worn down the defenses, and defenses are just completely tired. As we said earlier, that, you know, it's just a matter of time until Chris Carter is going to come up with a big play. He started there. It's the same play that Herman Moore caught his touchdown on. It's that little flatten up. He came all the way across in motion. Didn't let him get settled. Just ran a flatten up.
Revez will try extra points. So if they can get in range, they're going for this tie and perhaps overtime. 41. 38. Sunday, we remind.
You know, over the years, we've had turkeys where, you know, just one guy carries a turkey out there. This Dave. Time, we have 2 guys carrying a turkey out there.
Your 2 drivers.
Yeah.
Dave Hunt.
Willie Yarbrough. That's a big turkey. Now they're not the players aren't going to get all that one because I got to ride to New York and I'll guarantee you when we get there Sunday that's going to be a carcass.
That is going to be a king size carcass.
Yeah, well, I mean it has to be a king size carcass.
And they're going to call out the people from the museum to check it out.
Yeah, but I mean, well, the legs you have to. The bigger the carcass, the more legs you need. It's simple. It's science is what it is.
Yeah.
Biology, it's physiology, it's anatomy.
I think anatomy is right.
You know, I don't know if I were the Minnesota Vikings, I don't think I'd kick an onside kick here.
Not with this much time, 2:07.
And they still have 2 minutes to 2 timeouts, plus they're going to get a 2-minute time, so they have 3 timeouts. I think this is a mistake here, kicking an onside kick against an onside prevent.
The Lions are expecting it. Revez bounces it. The man with the good hands.
Yeah, that was unbelievable. They didn't need that. They didn't need that. They had plenty of time, and all they needed was a field goal to tie. And you know, now the Lions have a chance to put a lid on this thing with this excellent field position.
They'll get to stop the clock in 2 seconds, and then 2 timeouts.
Yeah, you see, they kick an onside kick, which could be okay, but the Detroit Lions are in an onside prevent. You see, they have their hands team in there. And they kicked it right to Herman Moore. Maybe you would try the onside kick if they didn't have a prevent team in there. But I don't believe you should have done that against an onside prevent.
First and 10, Detroit. Sanders stopped at the line of scrimmage by Randall. Now we should get the 2-minute warning. Detroit 41, Minnesota 38. Black and blue division. First down. Second down for the Lions. Mitchell going deep for Moore. Moore makes the catch. That was a big catch by Herman Moore.
That is a great catch. That's what Scott Mitchell was talking about. Herman Moore is as good or better when he's being covered, and he was covered tightly. Watch, he has his jersey out now. This is the end of a long day. He's just going up. You just throw the ball up there, and Herman Moore is going to get it. That was a great catch. We just throw a jump ball up to him, and he's going to get the ball.
That's, first down, Detroit.
That's not a bad idea, that the guy likes it more when he's covered than when he's open.
The give is to Sanders. Sanders chases and goes down, not much. Roderick Thomas made the stop.
Yeah, when you have three wide receivers, these are the numbers you like to see. You like to see it spread around. Look at this. Brett Perriman, 12 for 153. Herman Moore, 8 for 126. And Johnny Morton, 7 for 102.
All of them over 100 yards.
And I'll tell you, and then the offensive line really did a good job of blocking. And Scott Mitchell, to me, today has been amazing.
This is a Minnesota timeout, a minute 34 left. Our Miller Light player of the game is the Detroit quarterback, Scott Mitchell. He has hung in there.
Because he was knocked out of the game on Sunday with an ankle and a knee. And there was no way that they thought he'd be able to play. And then he practiced on Tuesday and Wednesday. That's Don Majkowski right behind him. Even yesterday, Majkowski said, I think I'm going to be in the game. I don't think that Scott Mitchell will be able to play the whole game today. He said he's going to try and gut it up or gut it out. He sure did.
410 yards. We're going to run out of time before we have a chance to present our Turkey Leg Awards, but you'll see them Sunday on the pregame show. You'll see the presentation and another look at the turkey. Mitchell gets to Sanders. Sanders. Stutter step. And again, Orlando Thomas made the stop. Again, the Vikings take a timeout, and that's all for them. 1:26 left, so they should get the ball back if Detroit doesn't do anything on the next snap.
Warren Moon knew if he could get it back that he could beat them, but they couldn't get it back. Again, I was surprised by that onside kick. I think that they could have, you know, with the two timeouts and the 2 minute warning, they could have kicked the ball deep. But then after that, if they get a first down, then it doesn't make any difference anyway. Chris Carter has to be thinking that, you know, that we can beat these guys. These guys can't stop us. You know, we can throw anytime we want to. We can get open anytime we want to. All they have to do is get the ball to us, but you have to have the ball to make that happen. It's kind of the last team that has the ball wins, and looks like the last team with the ball is going to be the Detroit Lions.
Well, Green Bay leads the NFC Central at 7-4. Both these teams will be, if the result is like it is right now, both of these teams will be 6-6. And Detroit, always at the end after Thanksgiving Day, seems to make a rush.
Well, yeah, because they get a 10-day break here. You know, the bad thing is you have a short week to Thanksgiving, but if you win the game after that, you have an extra few days to rest up.
Mitchell to Sanders. Sanders taken down behind the line of scrimmage at about the 24-yard line. And here comes the Detroit field goal team. They'll take as much time off the clock as they can.
You see, and not to second guess too much, but had they not gone for the onside kick, this, instead of being a field goal attempt, would be a punt way back there, and the Vikings would again get the ball in a lot better field position.
Clock still running, less than a minute. Hansen will let it run out. Down to 5 seconds. And now they call timeout. Detroit stops the clock. They have one timeout left. There are 40 seconds left on the game clock. Not over yet, however, the way these Vikings can explode with the receivers and the quarterback they have.
Yeah, and if Detroit makes this field goal here, then they're going to have to kick off.
Yeah.
And they know what happens when they kick off today. They've had some big returns. there's a lot of things wrong with this. One is a turkey on a football field, and two is the football field being artificial turf, and three is a roof on the stadium.
Well, the turkey. What's that around the turkey?
Well, that's stuff.
Asparagus, yeah. And grass.
No. Just they call it
stuff.
No, they call it, you know, where you put stuff around. What do you call that? Where you
debris?
No.
Okay.
Garnish.
Hansen's kick from 39 yards is good, and it's Detroit 44, excuse me. Minnesota 38. Now
it comes down to special teams again and a return. Now, you know the way things have been going for the Lions kickoff team, that they aren't going to kick the ball deep. I mean, yeah. They're not going to kick an onside kick. They're going to kick one of those, you know, squid type thing, line drive type thing, try and kick it just beyond the wedge. But they're not going to kick it up high and let them have one of those good return balls.
Remember that highlight we showed before, the shortest overtime game in history? When the Bears brought the overtime kickoff back. Following football, we remind you that there is Skate International coming up.
You know how many passes have been thrown in this game today?
No.
95. So we're going to go over, you know, combine both teams, we're going to go over 100. See Wayne Fonts limping out there. He hurt his ankle a couple of weeks ago. He called his special teams team on the field, and they ran on the field. He's talking to a guy, and his team ran right over him.
He never did find out who did it.
Oh, then the ankle got worse and worse, and now he got some big old brace thing on that goes up to his knee.
Got that high ankle sprain that they have here in Detroit.
Yeah, you see how the Vikings spread out here. They're expecting one of those line drive kicks.
Hansen sights it in.
And then goes sideways some more.
35 seconds left. He kicks off deep. Ismail at the four. Now he's taken down by Dan Owens. He tried to get around the corner, couldn't make it. 28 seconds left.
That's something, having a big defensive lineman on that kickoff coverage, but he made the play. They needed it.
Skate International of France coming up right after football. 44-38 Detroit.
Jason Hansen happy with himself. He got a good high kickoff. They had a good coverage. I was surprised that they did. I was surprised they gave him anything to return, but they did.
28 seconds left. Moon goes back in the shotgun for the first time. Gets it outside to Ismail, who gets out of bounds. Got enough for a first down. And used 6 seconds.
And now the Vikings, of course, because of that last field goal by the Lions, the Vikings have to score a touchdown. So the Vikings have to think, you know, a couple of big plays. They have to get the ball up the field. Conversely, the Lions are thinking prevent defense, you know. Let them catch some things. Let them catch a short one. But make sure they catch him in front of you, and you don't let them get out of bounds.
Ismail got out of bounds. Flag.
Corey Springer moved on that one.
Part of the snap. Ball start. 66 offense. 5 yards to deep first down.
I guess it was good. John Garrick. I thought it was Corey Springer.
Springer did move.
Yeah, maybe they both moved. That's the thing. You get in pass protection. They've been pass protecting all day. That about putting pressure on guys. The pressure to pass as many times as these teams have passed, it's going to approach 100 times, it really puts a lot of pressure on those guys that have to block for them.
Moon up under the center, back to throw. Ismail out of bounds.
That's the thing that you teach. Keep everything in front of you and don't let them get out of bounds. Ismail came all the way across. All the way across to get out of bounds. Now here's what a prevent is. You see, you want to keep everything in front of you. You see, you just go deep, 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 and all these guys are keeping stuff in front of them. Now, when they throw it and they do complete it in front of you, you have to converge and tackle. You can't let them come all the way across. You see, Ismail catches it here, and then he runs like 40 yards across the field to get out of bounds.
10 seconds remaining. Moon out of the shotgun. Palmer gets out of bounds with 4 seconds remaining.
That was a heck of a play by Warren Moon, because what he wanted to do with that play is get it close enough so that he can take this one into the end zone. He couldn't have thrown into the end zone from there. But now in this position here, he can throw the ball from here into the end zone. So there's two things we have to remember. He has to get the ball in the end zone. The other thing is the game cannot end on a defensive penalty.
Warren Moon and Denny Green don't have a lot of gray hair yet, but games like this will change it in a hurry. First and 10. Bad snap. Moon gets away. I'm not sure what happened. No time left on the clock.
Yeah, but they can't stop the clock during the play. It can't be that. It had to be a stoppage before the ball was snapped, I would imagine.
They got to have another play, don't they?
The game clock to 4 seconds. 4 seconds.
Reset the game clock.
Delay a game offense. 5 yards. Repeat first down.
Now, see, there was no play. That whistle did blow before the ball was snapped.
Wayne Font saying everybody get back.
Oh, yeah, but and the two things that he has to be thinking of is that they're going to throw some kind of jump ball and that, you know, don't foul. Herman Moore's back there on defense. They have Herman Moore is playing a deep corner way back on this right side.
Three-man rush. Moon evades. Throwing deep and throwing too far. Out of the end zone. Herman Moore came over, but there's a flag on the play.
And remember, it can't end. The game can't end on a defensive penalty.
The Vikings,
if it's against Detroit, they get another play.
They're going to get another shot.
If it's against Detroit, they get another play.
Offside,
if it's against the Vikings,
defense, no. Number 55 lined up in the neutral zone.
Ooh.
5 yards.
Antonio London
down.
Lined up in the neutral zone.
They're so tired they can't even get off one knee. Antonio London been rushing the passer all day. Again, the neutral zone is the length of the ball. Antonio London is right up here. Here's the ball right here. So if he lines up in that area where the football is, he's in the neutral zone.
The line of scrimmage is back at the 38-yard line.
What a defensive back. The back guy, the deepest guy, is Chris Spielman now.
And Herman Moore.
Herman Moore's deep on the other side. What's Chris Spielman doing playing safety?
I haven't figured that one out. Here's Moon. Must be intercepted by the reaction of the crowd. It is. By Sean Van Horst. And the Lions are going to win a thriller. They do win a thriller. 44-38. Detroit over Minnesota.